together one of the most formidable pitching staffs in baseball. Not to mention what Corey Bradford's done. He's the Dane Dunning of last year so far. And with the home runs, they're going to come. Nathan Lowe's going to come back. Like you said, the lineup is going to be impossible to navigate. You've got to pitch to somebody. And when you do, that's when the home runs start to come into play. That's when the ball's starting to get driven all over the park. This team is built for years to come, and everybody just needs to relax and let it happen.
Yeah, I appreciate it, Brad, 100% with everything you said right there. And again, we all come off the high of last October where every game means so much. Everything is riding on, you know, every single pitch. And now you start fresh over 162 games. It's like, okay, we all just need to, you know, step back a little bit. And, you know, even though they say the games in April mean the same as they do in September, they don't feel the same in April as they do in September. They certainly do not. But you look, and if you, and in there's a lot of ifs in there from what Brad said. If the starters come back, like, they can pitch like they have in the past, like a Scherzer, like a DeGrom, like a Tyler Mahle. You know, you get these guys back. Josh Young comes back from the injury. Lowe as well. If you get all those things, Rangers are going to be a real tough team. And again, I think we still have some of the same concerns that we had last year. At least I do. You know, you're still concerned about, you know, certain aspects of that Rangers bullpen, although I like what I've seen from Jacob Latz early on from the left side. Certainly, you know, Brock Burke was off to a difficult start, made even worse by, you know, punching the wall. Once again, Wall remains undefeated. Wall will never be defeated in a battle of a punch. So certainly, you know, with him breaking his hand, that certainly, you know, lessens your help from the left side of the bullpen. But, you know, it just presents an opportunity. And we saw what Cole Wynn did yesterday. And I don't know how long Cole Wynn is going to be up here with the Rangers. But, you know, he made a nice first impression yesterday with those, you know, five batters that he faced, retiring all five of those. You know, this is still a really good baseball team. Is it the best team in the American League West? Right now, you would say yes. I think they're better than what, I mean, the Astros have all sorts of pitching problems. And the Astros are pretty much saying the same thing. Well, they say, well, let's wait until we, you know, Justin Verlander, he potentially could pitch at the end of this week. You know, we'll see about, you know, Framber Valdez, you know, what transpires with him. But they're another team that's trying to get healthy. And the Angels, you know, they're just kind of the Angels. They feel like an 81-81 team, don't they? Seattle's the team that, you know, I can't figure out. They've got all this great pitching. They can't hit. That was the same problem they had last year. Could not hit. Let's go back to the phones. 877-881-1053. Talking Rangers baseball with you here on this Monday night. Let's go down to Corsicana to talk with our friend Greg. Greg, you're up next. What's on your mind? Go ahead.
Hey, Mike. It's great to talk to you again, man. It's good to hear you in a new season, Texas Rangers World Series season. So we can all be thankful for that. I got a crazy idea to throw across you, see if you hit it. What do you think about when DeGrom come back, we change gears and have him be a closer where you're only asking him to pitch one or two innings? He only got through four innings basically all season last year in four games. So if we ask him to pitch a quarter or a half that, maybe he can stay healthy.
Certainly not out of the realm of possibility, Greg, this year. You know, I think down the road, if you look towards next year, in 2025, you're paying him a lot of money. I don't think you want to pay him that much money to be the closer. Excuse me, everybody. Got a frog in my throat. It's been a long time since I've done this. It's like my spring training. But, you know, depending on when he comes back and depending upon what the Rangers' needs are at the time, certainly could see Jacob, you know, maybe pitching an inning or two coming out of the bullpen. I think it's too early to tell of what the plans are, but I think certainly best case scenario, you would want him being a starter. Because when healthy, we have seen just how dominant of a starter he can be. Absolutely dominant. Now, at the end of this season, when he's just coming back from Tommy John, if he's in a bullpen role, could he handle it? Sure, he could. The problem then is, can he pitch back-to-back days? Can he pitch three times in 5 days? That is the issue when it would come to Jacob DeGrom. But that is a topic for a much different day. With what the Rangers have right now, again, it's so early in the season. You just can't make too much judgments. When you played 17 games out of 162, we got, 145 of these to go? Gosh, this season is long, isn't it? The Major League Baseball season is so long. When you think, you know, the NBA games, they play 82. Hockey, you get 80. Baseball, you get 162. 162. NFL, you get 17. Baseball, we get 162 of these to try to dissect it, especially when you do it on a night-in, night-out basis. That's why baseball is so much fun, because it is every single day, and there are so many ebbs and flows in a Major League Baseball season. It's crazy, and I think sometimes we forget just the Rangers are going on a streak where they're going to win 8 out of 10. And sometime this year, Rangers are going to go on a streak when they lose 8 out of 10. Happens. You just don't want to do it at the wrong time. Rangers almost did it at the wrong time last year. In fact, they did. It cost them the division. Then the playoffs started, and the Rangers got hot. And guess what happened? They won the World Series. It's not always the best team that wins the World Series. It's the team that gets hot at the end. And last year, the Rangers were that team. Just get in the tournament. Just get in the tournament. That's all you are looking for. Get in the tournament. It's easier if you win the division, but not necessarily a requirement to win the division, said the Rangers, who were up there, the 5 seed last year. Again, you win the division, you get the time off. Remember, that was a huge topic of conversation last year, wasn't it? With the teams that didn't play Sunday, and then they waited 4 or 5 days, and you see the Dodgers get knocked out by the Diamondbacks. See the Braves go down to the Phillies. All these teams that had sat and rested. Meanwhile, teams like the Rangers that just kept playing, stayed in the rhythm. I don't know what Major League Baseball can do about it. I don't know what they can do about it right now in terms of the amount of rest for the teams with the best records before they start their division series. Because you got the best of three wild card games you got to play. Suits, much wiser than me, probably need to figure that out. And whether or not this is a trend or whether it's just, a one-off, maybe a two-off, I don't know. It'll be interesting to see how it plays out coming up here this October. But on this particular night, Michael Lorenzen wasn't very good in his 3 rehab starts. You wondered how he was going to fare. Now, again, the Tigers, not exactly a great lineup. But you look what Michael Lorenzen did in his 3 rehab starts. He had a 6.35 ERA. 8 earned runs in 11 and a third innings. Last Wednesday, 4 2/3 innings, gave up 4 runs, 6 hits, 5 walks in a game against Oklahoma City. But I tell you, Michael Lorenzen is going to love pitching with this defense behind him. He had a good defense with him in Detroit last year. He was an all-star. Went to Philadelphia, didn't have a very good defense. Outside of the no-hitter, didn't go so well. He's going to have a really good defense playing behind him with Seager, Semien. You put Nathaniel Lowe over there. You get Josh Jung back down the road. That's a real good defensive lineup. And he is certainly a guy that's not going to be a strikeout pitcher. Not going to get a lot of swing and misses. He had 4 strikeouts in 5 innings today. The ball's going to be put in play. And he gets the ball hit on the ground. Guys behind him are going to make the plays. And I think you need to give a big tip of the cap to Josh Smith. Boy, how valuable has Josh Smith been so far here early in the season? Taking a lot of reps over at third base with Josh Jung out. And Josh Smith, we always know he can field. He's got a strong arm. I don't think we expected the kind of production that we've seen, with the bat. Early on in the season, he came in, hitting over 300. So Josh Smith has been a very valuable piece here early on in the season, just kind of stemming the tide of that Josh Jung injury. But tonight, it was his defense. 3rd, 4th, and 5th innings, beginning 6-4-3 double plays. The first one was the best one. Then the other two were routine. Of course, in the 5th inning, they get the bases loaded, 1 out. And then Lorenzen makes the big pitch. So good work by him. Leody Taveras makes the nice diving catch. You win a ball game 1-0, folks. You need some defense. Rangers had the defense today. Offensively, you're looking for the power. And again, playing in Detroit, not a great hitter's ballpark. Especially when you're going to try to, you know, hit the ball out of the ballpark. It is not an easy place for hitters. But eventually the home runs are going to come for this club. They will. I mean, Adolis Garcia's got 4. Evan Carter's got a couple. Simeon's got a couple. This team's going to find that long ball range. Now, last year, I think we were spoiled because, you know, they were putting up 10 runs like they were going out of style. You know, Ezekiel Duran got off to that fast start last year. Just look at the Rangers' home runs. Let's see. Carter's got 2. Jonah Heim's got 2. Langford doesn't have any. Corey Seager's only got 1. Simeon's got 2. Yeah, they just... Leody doesn't have any. Jared Walsh has 1. Wenzel doesn't have 1 yet. Langford doesn't have 1. Kisner doesn't have 1. Jankowski's got 1. They just haven't hit the ball out of the ballpark. And once this team starts hitting the ball out of the ballpark, that's when the runs are going to start coming. And again, you'd like to say, well, it's because it's April. It's cold. Did you realize that today was the first game that the Rangers played that wasn't indoors or a place that had a retractable roof? Because the Rangers have had their home games, right? Then you look at the games the Rangers have played so far here on the road at Tampa Bay and at Houston. Got Tropicana Field, got the Dome. Houston never opens up the roof. It could be sunny and 75 with 0% humidity, and Minute Maid Park's roof will be closed. I've never understood that. Why even have a retractable roof? Houston never uses it. Just another reason to hate the Astros, right? So this was the first game that the Rangers played that was actually, you know, outdoors. Now, the Rangers have had the roof open just a couple of times so far this season. But the weather tonight wasn't a problem. It was 67 degrees in Detroit. You take 67 degrees in the upper Midwest in April, you take that and run. That's a great day. That is a great day there in the upper Midwest. But, hey, the Rangers got themselves a W. They bounced back from, you know, the tough losses that they had over the weekend in Houston. You know, we've seen this team now lose their last couple of series. It's time to win a series. And they've got 3 more games coming up here with the Tigers, all 12-10 first pitches. So our pregame show tomorrow is going to get going at 11:30 as John Gray with an 0-1 record, a 4.38 ERA, will be on the mound. John was really good in his last start, had the 5 innings, gave up just the 1 run, struck out 9. He's going to go up against Casey Mize. No record for Detroit. He has a 4.82 ERA. That's the one you want to get tomorrow because on Wednesday, Tarek Skubal is going for Detroit, and he's been really good so far this year. He has an ERA of just over 2. That one will be a tough one. We don't know who's going to start yet for the Rangers on Wednesday or Thursday, but we know John Gray will get the ball coming up tomorrow. So that's going to put a wrap up here on this edition of Rangers Extra Innings brought to you by Uber Eats, delivering home run deals to your front porch. We'll have game 2 of the series for you tomorrow, 11:30. Jared and Matt will have the call coming up at 12:10. My name is Mike Peasley. That will wrap it up by seeing the bullpen. We've got Reggie. We've got Chris Arnold warming up. They will take you home the rest of the night. Thanks so much for listening. Rangers beat the Tigers 1-0. Have a great night, everybody.
Pizza's here.
Oh, great. I'd love some, but I'm worried about my stomach issues.
If you're worried about having diarrhea, gas, bloating, stomach pain, or loose, oily stools, it may not just be stomach issues. It could be a condition called exocrine pancreatic insufficiency, or EPI. With EPI, the pancreas doesn't release enough enzymes to break down food, but EPI...
It's time for the Get Right on 105.3 The Fan.
Yes, indeed. It is the Get Right right here on 105.3 The Fan. My name is Reginald Adatula. That is the ooh-wee of the three-time Hall of Famer, Chris Arnold.
Got you down.
We got Ross Lebensky on the ones and twos, and you rolling with us after a Rangers 1-0 victory on the road.
Shut out.
In Detroit against the Detroit Tigers.
First one of the season.
First one as well with Michael Lorenzen on the bump.
Hey.
Good outing for that.
Welcome to the Rangers.
That's Michael. Right. That's right. A good outing for him. And then also a good showing as a teammate, because he looked up as a dude who is not a swing and miss guy. Right. I was looking at his Baseball Savant page. The, you know, the strikeout percentage, maybe not a big place. He's a contact hitter or a contact pitcher, contact, right? He pitches the contact. And you could tell he was happy to be in front of this Texas Rangers defense because he made sure to shout him out in that postgame show.
He sure did. He said, no more Swiss cheese. No, something like that.
Wow. So that was a great thing. It was encouraging as well to see another pitcher that felt comfortable, especially with, you know, his rehab assignments weren't dazzling necessarily.
Right.
But you get him up there, and he looks more than competent on the mound.
Same guy that pitched a no-hitter last season.
Yeah.
And then got tired as well because he was all these innings. And again, that defense showed up big time for him. He pitched 5 scoreless innings. But more importantly for him, he actually, like you said, he had some guys behind him. It was kind of like in the NBA when Luka and Kyrie said, oh, my God, we got Gafford and PJ. We got some guys that can go to the rim. Oh, my God, I got get happy.
Yes, a solid 1-0 win on Jackie Robinson Day. All the gentlemen wearing 42 on the diamond. 9-8 is the new record for your Texas Rangers. Still remain atop the AL. Offense not really offensing early on in the season like we wanted. Obviously, at Comerica Park, the ball's not necessarily gonna get out of there. But still a little surprising to see. I mean, we don't have to get deep into it, but do you have any theories on why the offense quite isn't where you would typically expect from this Texas Rangers lineup?
Well, it's kind of changed up a little bit. I mean, Josh Jung ain't there. He's part of the reason. If it seemed like there's going to be somewhat of a slump or something, he's always there up until, you know, those couple of times he got hurt. But that was like late in the season. I literally think people underestimate the impact of Josh Jung. Mm-hmm. I just do. And then, you know, Corey Seager's not starting off strong, so what can you say?
Right. Simeon.
He's clutch when you need him.
He gets the one RBI, making sure to leg out a situation and not get the double turned. So ends up being a RBI.
That was the difference, man.
And that was indeed the difference.
Jonah Heim with 2 hits, and I think he scored the run, but I think I want to say a 2. He might have won.
You're right. 2 for 4 on the evening, 1 run, and also a stolen base. When
aggressive.
Yeah. In a way, because it looked like they threw over to try and keep him on, and I was watching the TV copy where Mike Bacsik, obviously on the call there, and he was like, Josh Smith isn't going to run. I don't know why you're throwing over. And literally the next pitch, Josh Smith goes and takes second with no throw. So that was fun. Shout out to the Texas Rangers getting a 1-0 win on the one evening game, if you want to call it that. On this particular series, the remainder of them will be day games against the Detroit Tigers for your Texas Rangers Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. So that means you'll get myself and CA tomorrow, and then myself and Blake on Wednesday and Thursday, full get rights with a little bit of day baseball for the rest of, or I guess throughout the rest of the series. Let's say for the rest of the week, but Friday you're going to get an evening game as well. But yeah, shout out to the Texas Rangers. I don't know, reverse shout out to the Dallas Cowboys, as we've got you on the Get Right today till midnight, actually. I was about to say till 11, but we've got you till midnight, taking you through the remainder of your Monday evening. You can always get involved with the program by texting in to the truckwreck.com text line, or actually it's the Frankel Injury Attorney text line, 877.
Same people
for sure, but I want to make sure I get that right. 877-881-1053.
Right.
Also, if you would like to see our smiley faces, we do have the fan cam going. You can search 105 through the fan on YouTube or youtube.com/105 through the fan. Twitch.tv/DallasFanCam, all the various places you can see us. The reason why I said, I guess, the opposite of a shout out for your Dallas Cowboys, I guess there should be a normal shout out, as voluntary workout started today. We are already in that cycle.
They're required, by the way.
I mean,
they're required voluntary, but they call them. I'm just bringing up the, yeah, right. You know what I'm saying?
Depending
on who you are, but they quote unquote say it's required, in that, you know, you're really not supposed to miss anything until like later on. But they had a meeting today.
Yes, they did. They did have a team meeting, and a
couple people didn't show up.
At least one of them was incredibly notable as CeeDee Lamb, your number one wide receiver, the dude who really has showed himself in a big way this past season to be a number one wide receiver, not just a, you know, best wide receiver on a roster, but as we typically around the league refer to number one wide receivers, he does not show up. And it's very obvious as to the reason why. I don't think that it raises a ton of alarms because, again, technically these are voluntary. And the caliber of player that he has reached, you end up with some of those guys missing these things for various reasons. However, the reason he's missing it is the particular thing for these Cowboys and the way reason why I give them a reverse shout out because he is entering the fifth season of his rookie deal, and they have yet to work out an extension with him. In fact, I don't know that we've had very many talks in that regard, at least when it comes to what we've seen reported. Of course, that's not the end-all be-all. There could be talks happening. I don't know. But they have not gotten to that place where they have gotten pen to paper. And this, I think this is a little bit of a voicing without voicing of the displeasure with that. And I think it speaks to something that the Cowboys don't do well, which is getting their work done early, particularly with contracts and the ones that matter. And there's the reason why this comes up again is not just because CeeDee Lamb misses a little, you know, the start of voluntary workouts today. It's also juxtaposed with what happened with your biggest division rivals, the Philadelphia Eagles, who we got news of today.
Ding, 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 ding.
That one of their wide receivers, who is not going to set the market, don't get me wrong, but DeVonta Smith, the draft pick out of Alabama, as soon as he's eligible for an extension, does indeed get a 3-year extension today.
$75 million, $51 million guaranteed like clockwork. It's like there's no drama in Philly. But why is there always drama in the Dallas Cowboys? Again, let me refresh everybody's memory. As we mentioned, this is like, you know, voluntary workouts. There's no, you can't do any hitting. It's strictly, according to the collective bargaining agreement, strength and conditioning. But the OTAs are what's important. And CeeDee Lamb ain't there, but guess who else is not there? Micah Parsons is not there. Dak Prescott is there, but Micah Parsons is not there. And Micah's people said it has nothing to do with his contract. He just don't want to be there right now. I want everybody to refresh their memory just last year. Zach Martin had to miss part of training camp.
Yes, he did.
Just to get his raise that was like, come on, y'all know I'm one of the best in the league. I'm severely underpaid at this point. And I've been giving y'all some, you know, hooking y'all up with these little things, keep y'all under the cap, and no love for me? He had to go there. So CeeDee Lamb, like you said, same day that DeVonta Smith got his 3-year extension, $75 million, $51 million up front. He ain't there, but he's like, I understand the business part of it. The question is, will he be there for the OTAs? Will he be a holdout? Well, guess what? Zach Martin did something refreshing everybody's memory.
Yes, sir.
Before he missed training camp in Oxnard and finally came in just for his over with, he did what they called a hold in. He was there in the building at the Star. He just wasn't working out. And that's when everybody knew, uh-oh, something's up. He's here, but he ain't working out. And T.J. Watt did the same thing. Remember T.J. Watt? He was at Pittsburgh and they're OTAs, he wasn't lifting nothing, wasn't hitting nobody.
Yeah, and that's in part because of the new rules that make it, I mean,
$101,000 is what they can fine you.
Yeah, and I would definitely
even
call
though
that,
you say, oh, you're getting millions, that's still $101,000.
Right, I would definitely call that prohibitive.
You can buy mama a house with that.
That's right. Maybe not. I mean, after a few days, you could definitely buy mama a house with that.
Condo.
and so, yeah, I don't think that he'll miss real time. I don't think that that's something that makes sense.
Did it make sense that Zach Martin had to miss real time?
Okay. I mean, look.
I'm just saying.
I hear you.
I'm just saying this is not unusual for the Cowboys, which is stupid on their part.
I think that I'll say it again. My personal opinion, I think
Zeke
he'll be
went
there.
I have to go back to Zeke.
No, you're
Zeke
right.
Ain't the only one. I bring it up Zach Martin because, man, Zeke, hey, you know, he did the hit. But, all right. It ain't even Zeke. How about last summer?
Sure. No, you're right. Like there's been instances where
they
players have had to apply.
They call it they have a history.
Right. They have to apply that pressure. But I think really the issue comes back to, I think the Cowboys, the way that they operate in going about these decisions, it feels like it's smarter to do what we've seen the Eagles do in this instance, which is go ahead, especially with the players that are, it seems obvious on, And I don't know, maybe this is below the belt or whatever, but don't be cheap in this regard and think, well, these are the cheap times, I'm going to continue to use some of the cheap years and then pay them. Pay them ahead of time, because you know the market only continues to go up. And for a player like CeeDee Lamb, or a player like Micah Parsons, where it was abundantly clear that this is going to be a player that's going to be valuable to you for a long time, go ahead and put that extension on the books, because it ends up working out. Now, there's instances where it does not work out, and I understand that, but for the most part, it's going to end up working out in your benefit. And at the very least, you can look at the way that you've been doing it, and you have to look at the wins and losses, the theoretical wins and losses of the negotiations of these contracts, and you've got to look at the ways in which you have lost a lot of these and maybe switch up your approach.
Put it like this. I don't want to age myself too much, but anybody over the age of 35, any Tolos out there over the age of 35 know where I'm going with this. There used to be a TV commercial that was classic on television all the time. The Maytag repairman. And he had a saying at the end of the commercial, you can pay me now or pay me later.
Yeah.
The price is only going to go up for CeeDee Lamb, Dak Prescott, and Micah Parsons. It doesn't make any sense to F around and find out. It makes no sense. But Jerry's got a philosophy of deadlines make deals. Steven just has a philosophy of effing around and finding out.
And either way, like, those things are true, but for whom, right? The deadline makes the deal, but it feels like of late the deal has been made in the favor of the player, which
personally,
I'm not upset about.
Yeah, all However, players get their money.
From the organization's perspective, if you were trying to do this correctly and make, you know, put yourself in the best position to succeed, I feel like that's got to change. And you are in a season where if they did not do a ton, and some of that is because of, you know, the financial situations that they are in, but these are the reasons why you end up in those financial situations where you have to try and figure out how to manage that money, because you have not handled your business on the front end as properly as I believe you should have.
What you just said succinctly was they wind up kicking the can down the road. Well, why do you wind up kicking the can down the road? Because you won't pay less now, you wind up paying more later, and thus kicking the can down the road every year, saying, well, we're in cap hell. There's only so much piece of the pie, Steven says. And guess what? You would have had that pie in check if you paid, again, Dak Prescott, $30 million, just way too much money. And then several months later, it's $40 million minimum. Now it's $59 million. And for those who say, well, just let him walk, guess what? Just like Ezekiel Elliott, you still going to be paying him next year. If he walks away in January, you still are going to be paying him because you owe him that money because you kicked the damn can down the road. And that's called bad business, isn't it?
I mean, I would imagine so. I'm not no business person, but
you play one on TV.
That's right. So get right here on 105 Through the Fan. I still maintain CeeDee Lamb not showing up for the first day of voluntary meetings is not the worst thing in the world. No. But I think the biggest thing, as we talked about, it highlights what has been a structural issue in the way that this team is team builded. And this is the team building time of year, as we are, 10 days away from the NFL draft 2024. They've put a lot of pressure on themselves to draft well, and one of the places where they draft well, CeeDee Lamb, it doesn't feel like they're doing the continuation of helping that be successful for them. We'll continue to see.
You would think they would have learned something before Amari got here, which was why receiver by committee don't work.
Well, it can't be smart to go to that place, but we'll ultimately see where they end up. We again, 10 days till the draft,
who's that receiver they drafted when Amari left? Oh, we can just draft another one. I'm just saying.
Best of luck in that regard. It's the Get Right here on 105 Through the Fan. Just going on this Monday evening. We got you till midnight tonight. Midnight. Hang out with us here on the Get Right. Coming up next, the regular season is completed in the NBA. Grades for all the NBA teams, but also, what do you feel like you learned during the regular season with these Dallas Mavs? 877-881-1053. We'll discuss it next on the Fan. Get right right here on 105.3 The Fan. Reginald Atatula here with you alongside the three-time Hall of Famer Chris Arnold.
Got you down.
Appreciate you rolling with us on this Monday evening after your Texas Rangers get a 1-0 victory at Comerica Park in Detroit. I almost said Chicago, not the right place, but against the Detroit Tigers. You'll have John Gray up tomorrow in the day game, the first of three day games in a row against the Tigers in Detroit that you can hear right here on your home of the World Series champion Texas Rangers 105.3 The Fan. We got you till midnight. It's a fun one on a Monday evening, and it's been a fun one this season, particularly of late, the last, what, like 20, 25 games mm-hmm. for your Dallas Mavericks, who have officially completed their 82-game regular season, and they've got games to play, baby, because they are in the playoffs, set to face off against the Los Angeles Clippers. We have a date. The games will start on Sunday. We don't officially have a time yet, do we?
Not a time. Not that I've heard. But I mean, Sunday the 21st.
My best guess, and of course, we've got a whole week, right? We're leading up to this. But my best guess
LA.
Is... Yes, that's true. LA is the 4 seed, so they have
I'm guessing it's going to be a late game.
Exactly.
Or at least
I think this is prime time. Luka Doncic, yeah. High level.
And Kyrie. And versus Kawhi and Paul George and... James Harden and Russell Westbrook.
Yeah, this feels like it's going to be prime time. My mm-hmm. best guess, I don't know things. But with that being the case, we just finished the regular season. We saw it finish yesterday against, well, maybe you might not have saw it, against the Thunder. That was a game in which all...
The G League team showed up.
Yeah, all significant players outside of, I mean, guys that I imagine you'll see in the playoffs. Josh Green, Tim Hardaway Jr., maybe Jaden Hardy.
Maybe not.
Yeah, I was like, make sure I'm covering my bases.
The
here.
Game plan was do not get anybody hurt, not even in the rotation. Timmy, you need to work on your shot. Josh Green, you need to work on your shot. You just got back.
And get up to speed.
You know, get some reps in. They got their reps in, and it was an ugly blowout. But Oklahoma City had to win that game because they wanted to have the best record in the West. They played everybody.
They did, and they played hard to the point where it was a 50-some point game. I think it finished somewhere 50, 60. Mm-hmm. I don't know. And you don't need to know. That's not important here.
Yeah, that game was just, you made it out of there.
And so you finished with a 50-win season. We talked about that.
50-32.
877-881-1053. That is the Frankel and Frankel Injury Attorney text line. What did you learn from the regular season when it comes to these Mavericks? You know, I know that we didn't necessarily put on record some of our thoughts before the season, but I'm interested to see what we learned during the course of the season. And, you know, pair this with ESPN.com. They put together a full regular season grade for all 30 NBA teams. Kevin Pelton does a great job there mm-hmm. with those things. But I wanted to get more nitty gritty into it than just like a letter grade. But like some of the things that we learned over the course of this.
Did they grade? Tell us what the grade was and why they gave them that grade.
Yeah. So
we know from February 6th on, this was a whole different team.
Right. And with these Dallas Mavericks, clearly, there was a lot of things to be happy about as I continue to go back into it. But yes, I mean, the Dallas Mavericks ultimately 4 seasons got an A- from Kevin Pelton.
Not bad.
Midseason, he gave them a B-, and mm-hmm. the blurb that he writes for them says, everything clicked for the Mavericks after they added starters Daniel Gafford and P.J. Washington in deadline deals around the same time Kyrie Irving got healthy after missing 22 of the team's first 49 games. Mm-hmm. Add in MVP caliber campaign for Luka Doncic, and Dallas was one of the NBA's better teams after the break, moving up to the 5th seed in the West a year after finishing outside of the top 10. So, I mean, a very basic synopsis of the season, but absolutely correct, right? Like this thing just became different when they made that trade and they had more options available to them. I remember vividly that game against the Thunder. I believe that was the first one where you got those new guys in playing after the trade deadline. You did the Oklahoma City Thunder dirty, a team that had been playing well. And I remember tweeting out, oh, this is different now.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, they did to Oklahoma City basically what Oklahoma City did to their scrubs other night. Yesterday. It was just that simple. Just that quick. But it showed you how good this team could be immediately. And this shows you that the first part of the season, it was frustrating for Maverick fans, can you imagine the team themselves, because they were mid. It wasn't like they sucked, but they were mid. And the only reason they were any good at all, and Jason Kidd said it, but people didn't want to hear it, was their best defense was offense. In other words, if we make our shots, we win the games. They never had a losing record. And this was with a team that had more different starting lineups than any team in the league. They had more injury-related lineup changes than any team in the entire NBA, and yet they did not suck. They were mid. So when they made the move at the trade deadline, the fact that, okay, Jason Kidd's always been about defense. His assistant coaches know how to get a team to go play defense, which was proven just 2 years ago when they went to the Western Conference Finals. They had the third best defense in the NBA from January on.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, okay, that can be replicated. Guess what, though? This team is even better than that team was. I'm not saying they're going to the Western Conference Finals again, but this team can get points in the paint. They can get those lobs. And again, this team also has Kyrie on it. Earlier on this year, Kyrie missed 22 games.
Yes, sir.
When they made the trade, he had played three games, I think. He wound up playing more games in a row, 31, than he had played since 2016 when he was the Cleveland Cavaliers. And that impact alone showed you, guess what? You got PJ, you got Gaff, you got Luka, you got Kyrie. You got anybody else? You put Derek Lively, Derek Jones Jr. You got all these different pieces. The rotation that looks good. Oh, as the national experts are saying, this is a dangerous team. This team nobody wants to face because they can beat you all kinds of ways. And you got to give major props to Luka. They were mid because Luka wouldn't let them become mid. He was the star amid all that mess with all the injuries. And he kept it where they were still in the hunt. And all of a sudden, they just took off. Because remember, when they made those trades, they were flirting with eight. They were flirting with eight. That's as low as they went, flirting with eight.
Now, I talked about some of the things that we learned. I'll give you a couple of things for sure that I felt like I learned this season. And I'll start with this. Luka's ready to be a real deal superstar, right? And I want to preface all this by saying, remember, he is 25 years of age right now. He started this season 24 years of age, right? He was still always young. However, there were still questions of, is Luka going to take his health and fitness seriously? Is Luka going to get his head in the game and not allow other circumstances to take him out of those things?
The refs.
And the refs, right? Not necessarily getting fouls that he wants, what have you. He is shown a huge improvement in those ways, right? Like the ways in which, you know, he's shown up and he has looked maybe his healthiest all the time. And of course, some of this has to do with playing basketball in the offseason, which are things that I don't know that you can necessarily.
He brought over some chefs.
Right. You can not necessarily knock him for. But yes, he has gone to a place where now he is taking this a whole different level of seriously
something
in that regard.
Dirk used to do.
Absolutely, right? All them plates that we see him walk in with was in part because, you know, he loves his wife, but also making sure that he was on his grind, taking this this profession as seriously as I think is reasonable for him. And I think Luka Doncic reached that place in addition to the clear lock-in when it comes to you have to play on every portion of the court, both sides of the basketball. You've seen that. And those are the commitments to the game that you see from real deal superstars. He had the talent before. Now you're seeing, and I don't want to be too presumptuous, right? Because it's easy to then act like I know him, and I don't, right? But it feels like he has reached a point where he has that the mental lock-in as well as the physical and the skills to put this all together to be a superstar in the realest way and the biggest way in this league.
Two things happened to him this year that allowed him to mature a little bit quicker and grasp what he needs to do to be a more complete player. Number one, he had a baby daughter.
Yeah.
Okay. He and his fiance, Ana Rhea, they had a little baby daughter back in November. And that automatically matures the guy. It really does. If you have a kid, if you're around for the kid, if you stick around, you're not just, okay, I had a kid. The other part is Kyrie Irving. Do not underestimate the influence of Kyrie.
Yeah.
He totally admires the hell out of Kyrie. And Kyrie is chill. You don't see Kyrie arguing with refs. You don't see Kyrie being demonstrative. You follow what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And the entire league respects and admires Kyrie. The team does too, and so does Luka. And it's not just, I mean, you could see it now, all the chemistry. Well, guess what? Chemistry is a two-way thing. Kyrie's always respected Luka. He thinks this guy's phenomenal, but he also knows he's young. And it's ways that Kyrie does things. As Luka puts it, man, Kyrie's my guy. He's so humble. He has a way to get respect without demanding it. And that's the way Kyrie carries himself.
Yeah, that leads right into this one of the other things that I felt like I learned this season, which is Kyrie is a leader he always wanted to be.
Mm-hmm.
You'll remember that Kyrie Irving, the reason why he left the Clippers, or the, not Clippers, the Cavaliers, and I guess I say this definitively, is this the reason at least that we talked about on the outside. I don't know that we all know the actual internal, all those things, but it felt like the reason why is he wanted to go and be the guy with a team, not
kind of like what Kobe wanted when, you know, he wanted out of LA, yeah, and wanted to play for the Bulls and leave Shaq, and you know, he wanted to be the man. He didn't want to say people to say, well, you didn't get that title without Shaq,
right? Well, he goes to, remember, the Boston Celtics.
Mm-hmm.
And there, I think we definitely saw a desire to be a leader guy, especially on a team that was very young at that time. Remember, young same Jason roster. Tatum, young yeah, Jalen Brown, now, while a lot of,
yeah, Marcus Smart.
And then, I mean, Marcus Smart, not, mm-hmm, not super young, but relatively young. You had a lot of young guys on that team. Yeah. Kyrie Irving, you could tell, wanted to be the leader on that team.
And remember what happened? He got hurt going into the playoffs, and they kept going without him.
Mm-hmm.
And so his influence kind of changed, even though those guys still, they really love him. And he actually had a truce with the front office of the Celtics, but he wasn't able to be, quote unquote, that man the way he wanted to because injuries got him.
And I think also you looked around and you had a lot of young guys who seemingly just wanted to get their spots and get their opportunities to get theirs.
Exactly.
And so I don't think it fell the way that Kyrie would have wanted to be the leader that he was hoping that he could be. We know what happens in Brooklyn. There's a whole bunch of circumstances there, right? A lot of different inputs and factors that make that not the circumstance that he wants. This gave him the opportunity with a lot of young guys and guys who needed a leader and wisdom.
Right.
And with him being, again, maturing as well, he got an opportunity to be a leader. And Brian Damaris wrote an interesting piece for D Magazine where he talked about the moment that the Mavs season turned around, and he dated it March 5th. Which was the day that they had to have their team meeting. And you'll remember that the guys that Markieff Morris and Kyrie Irving.
Yep. And those guys were both with the Brooklyn Nets and came together, and they are really tight.
Right. And so with that being the case, you have these guys that that come in to be leaders, and Kyrie more than I think Markieff, not the saying that Markieff is not a leader, but I think being on the court, it changes. It's different
it
does. That way.
Kyrie can back it up. In other words, He's madly respected around the league. Everybody is unanimous saying he's the most skilled player in the NBA. Skilled could be a lot of things, but everybody knows the handles, just the way he can get his buckets whenever he needs them. But the thing he brought to the Dallas Mavericks is, as you said, he's more mature now, and he knows, I don't have to prove myself and say, this is my team, I'm the top dog. Because guess what? He's got a ring, and he won that ring hitting the game when he shot for Cleveland, playing with the greatest player of this generation in the 21st century, LeBron James. So he knows, okay, Luka, this is his team. I'm joining his team, and I'm going to help him. Let's win this thing together. I'm going to win another ring, and I'm going to help him get his ring. And they both respect the hell out of each other, which you can see the whole team. The chemistry is insanely off the charts.
Yeah, and then honestly, you get further confirmation as a continue to talk about some of the things that we learned during the season, that when you have the right personnel in there, Jason Kidd's system of things works.
It does.
We saw it in that Western Conference run, as you mentioned. But one season, anyone can try and, you know, wipe away at some level of fluke or what have you. You see it happen again with the right personnel and the right buy-in. And you have to give Jason Kidd a lot of credit. And I think that's another thing that we saw come together in the second half of this season.
You really did. And just to remind people there are people like to double down and they don't want to admit, guess what? I learned something new. Jason Kidd has had 250-win seasons in 3 years. Before Jason Kidd's first 50-win season, when they went to the Western Conference Finals 2 years ago, they'd had one 50-win season in 10 years. 10 years. When he was named the Brooklyn Nets head coach, first time coaching, he took a team that was veteran with Kevin Garnett, Jet Terry, Paul Pierce, those guys. They started off slow like this year's Mavericks team. You can look it up. Everything I'm saying, you can Google it up. They started off slow. People were saying he didn't know how to coach. By the time they got to January, they made a run like they're doing with the Mavericks right now. And guess what they did? They knocked off a Toronto team that didn't have Kawhi at the time. Had DeMar DeRozan. Had
Fred VanVleet and Kyle Lowry.
There you go. That team was a really good team. They knocked them out of the playoffs I think they were 7th or 8th seed. And Jason Kidd came in second in voting for NBA Coach of the Year. People don't remember that part. And because of the way he won with the Brooklyn Nets, he felt like he had the power to tell the front office, you got to do some things. We got to get these kind of moves made. And they wouldn't listen to him. And the reason he wound up with Milwaukee, he didn't get fired from Brooklyn. People, oh, he got fired. No, he didn't. He said, I want out. I know some people in Milwaukee, the new owners. I've known them from New York days. And they said, come here, J-Kid. And Brooklyn said, no. We want a first-round pick. In other words, they had to give up draft picks for him. That's how good of a coach he was with Brooklyn. And then you know the superstars swear by. Giannis, of course, with Milwaukee. LeBron, when he was a defense coordinator for the Lakers. So, again, even though toxic Twitter, Maverick style, last season and parts of this season were like, he can't coach. Yeah, he can. He just can't coach the way you want him to.
So those are some of the things that I feel like I learned and that we learned over the course of the regular season from the 214, or sorry, from the 940. This team might be better next year with the whole season together, and I think that's true. However, you don't have to wait till next season. There's still the playoffs to be had that begins on Sunday. Woo-hoo. As they start
in LA.
Yes, in LA at Crypto.com Arena, which is, by the way, the final time this postseason that the Clippers will play. Yeah, in that arena for their home arena. But yes, the Mavs begin their postseason run, and it starts on Sunday against the Clippers in L.A. So get right here on 105.3 The Fan. We got you till midnight. Been a fun one thus far. My name is Reginald Atatula. That is Chris Arnold. Coming up next, let's go around the NFL. An insider gives you an idea on maybe what to watch out for before the draft and some Rashi Rice updates. Rashi Rice. I got to say that right. I'll fix it in the break. We'll come up next on The Fan.
Coming up on the next KNC Masterpiece.
Get Right right here on 105.3 The Fan. Reginald Atatuli here with you alongside the three-time Hall of Famer Chris Arnold.
Got you down.
Thanks for rolling with us on this Monday evening in the Metroplex. We, the Get Right, got you till midnight. We jump on the air, or jumped on the air after your Texas Rangers got a win, 1-0 in Detroit earlier today, as heard on the Louisiana Hot Sauce Radio Network and right here 105 through the Fan, your home of the Texas Rangers. You'll be able to hear the remainder of that series Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, all day games. So you'll hear that with Matt and Jared as Eric Nadel has the week off.
And so does G-Back.
Basically. I mean, honestly, basically. As much as I
allegedly love, respectfully,
that's right. As much as I love Eric Nadel, I do love hearing Hixie and Jared together because they get along like brothers in the booth, and it's really fun to hear those gentlemen as well. So always fun to get those guys.
And you also get Mike Peasley on the pre and post game.
You sure do. You sure do. When Pease killed it when it came to extra innings earlier, talking about some of the things that I was super excited to hear about. But right now, let's go around the NFL here on the Get Right. And we begin with this. We talked earlier today, or we started the show talking about CeeDee Lamb and the ways in which we learned that he was not present earlier today at off-season voluntary conditioning.
Yeah, Dak was there. Micah Parsons was not, but he said it has nothing to do with contract.
That's right.
That's what he says, or his people says.
I mean, I okay, I'll leave that there. I feel like it's fair to assume that CDs has something to do with the contract, though. As he enters,
his people,
he enters year five of his rookie deal, the final year of his rookie deal.
They say that around the NFL, no superstar entering their fifth year shows up at a voluntary workout. They say it just didn't happen.
Yeah, and along those lines, Justin Jefferson was also not present.
Exactly.
At their voluntary offseason conditioning for those Minnesota Vikings. And obviously for the same reasons. The idea they have not figured out their extension. That's another player that you expect to be a market setter when it comes to wide receivers. And so, those are a couple of guys that continue to point to the idea that, hey, man, these wide receivers, they're about to set the market. And I don't know, teams aren't necessarily super excited to bring out their paychecks, or their checkbooks rather, to get that done.
Yeah, they can wait till after the draft, see which wide receivers go where. But at the same time, I got a random name of somebody who did show up at an off-season conditioning voluntary workout.
Oh,
I mean, by the way, this is just weights, lifting weights, and you cannot hit. You cannot. You know, coaches can't really do anything right now. But guess who showed up? You'll never guess who just showed up.
I have no idea. You tell me.
Okay, last year at this time, he was in a cave eating mushrooms.
What, Aaron Rodgers?
Yeah.
Okay.
He showed up at the Jets.
I mean, good for him.
That's what I'm saying. I thought he was going to run for president or vice president or something.
Nah, he didn't end up on the ticket. But I also imagine at his advanced footballing age, not necessarily saying that he is old.
And think
just
about
generally,
it. And think
get
about
yourself
it.
So right.
I mentioned that he was in a cave last year this time. Those last couple of years of Green Bay, he wasn't in Green Bay. I'm not around. I don't know if I want to come back.
And I mean, to be fair for him as well, like, you want to be the quarterback of that team. You do want to establish rapport. I know that what's the Hard Knocks?
Zach.
Oh. Right? They did Hard Knocks last year, and he was smiling in the camera and all those things. But
backing up in a big apple.
Making sure that you have all of that quarterbackly, you know, knowledge of what's happening, everything, I imagine would behoove you to be there in those moments. So shout out to him for doing that and showing up to their training camp, or their voluntary offseason conditioning is
wink,
what it's called.
Wink.
There you go. One of the reasons why the CeeDee Lamb thing was very evident to us, or maybe heard a little bit more, is because your rivals got a deal done with one of their star wide receivers, Devontae Smith, for the Philadelphia Eagles. They come to a 3-year, $75 million extension agreement. $51 million of that is guaranteed.
How'd they come up with 51 instead of like 50 or 52?
Well, I guess that basically, I mean, if the way that I typically view this is I try and take the average annual
more
value
than anybody else.
I try to take the average annual value and I go, okay, how many years is this guaranteeing? And it basically guarantees two of those years, right? If you take 375, that's 25 a year. So the first 2 years of that guaranteed. That's the way
I'm just saying 51, not 50.
Yeah.
51.
Yeah,
I need one more million and old boy down the street.
And sometimes that's all it is, right? Sometimes the numbers are just to make things look good. But in this instance, I think Howie Roseman continues to look good as an executive. Aren't y'all tired to talk about how Howie Roseman is doing good things for the Eagles?
Exhausted.
Tired.
They've been to 2 Super Bowls in the last 7 or 8 years. Cowboys ain't been to a Super Bowl or NFC Championship game this century.
Yeah.
Talking about the division rival over there doing stuff like this.
All right, let's move this along. I just had to get that in because it is around the NFL. And elsewhere around the NFL, something interesting. Jason LaCofora, who's an NFL insider, he writes for the Washington Post. And
he's popped on the Sean and RJ show.
Yes, he has. He's a notable NFL insider. He talked to several general managers and front office executives and said that they indicated that there could be multiple trades involving star wide receivers before the end of the draft that's starting next week.
Now, you know better than this. You are the one that coined the phrase, this is lion season.
It is lion season.
And sometimes general managers leak things on purpose. Sometimes agents leak things on purpose, and it just makes everybody, ooh, but you got to take a pause and say, is it a lie or is there something to this?
Well, let's try and suss that out as we go. He wrote, more of them will go, one general manager told him. Would you rather do what Nick Caserio just did or try to outbid bad teams with more cap space than they know how to burn to try and get them as an unrestricted free agent? That's kind of Econ 101, isn't it? Right. So I guess the idea being, if you trade for a guy who's not necessarily happy, you get the opportunity to not have to try and outbid these teams that are building up giant cap space roles where they have an opportunity to just go and outright throw a whole bunch of money at that player. Maybe that means something. Now, he did point to LaCofora, that is, pointed to some wide receivers that are out there that possibly could fit into this designation. Brandon Ayuk from the Niners, who, I mean, he hasn't gotten his money yet, and he's been somewhat vocal on social media about that. T. Higgins for Cincinnati, although Higgins earlier today said that he envisions himself playing with Cincinnati this season, which, what does that mean? I don't know, right? That can always shift. Cortland Sutton from Denver, wide receiver. DK Metcalf from the Seahawks. And Devontae Adams with the Raiders, who has also seemed to be, say that he's okay with the Raiders, but again, what does that mean? But those are names that you could possibly watch as possibly being guys that get traded before the end of the draft. So with that being the case, you believe in any of this?
No. No, it's lion season. Why? I've been around too long for this, man. It's like Jimmy Johnson used to call it poker. They're playing poker. You don't believe anything you hear right about now.
Well, I mean, I do think it's just an interesting thing.
Don't get me wrong. It is. It's very interesting. The theoretical is lovely. People love a conspiracy.
That's right.
A lie travels faster than the truth could ever get out the door. Just saying. It's just people love this time of the year.
And I appreciate you reminding. It's line season. But yeah, I mean, there are players out there that are not necessarily content. And maybe there are GMs out there that are looking around and saying, maybe that's how we get our hands on a very good wide receiver. I don't know. Obviously, CeeDee Lamb does not fall into that. So yeah, at least that's one thing you got going for you. As we continue around the NFL, obviously something that happened here locally in the DFW.
Speaking of wide receivers.
Wide receivers. Rashi Rice, who apparently could be
right
facing
down the street. And it's not even a mile down the central stretch from this building.
Literally on the highway that this building
2 exits down
is upon, right? Like there we saw Rashi Rice do some really, really bad, a really stupid, honestly, thing, which is, you know, drag racing in the middle of Saturday traffic.
And he was leasing both cars.
Yes, he was.
Driving one, but leasing both.
And with that being the case, obviously, no one was fatally injured, which is wonderful, but there were some injuries, some damage done. And during the course of that, that crash that happened on March 30th, there's might be more trouble coming after that, I should say. Rashi Rice and then Theodore Knox, who was the other driver, are being sued for $1 million by 2 of the victims of that incident, according to Fox 4 Kansas City. The plaintiffs, Irina Gromova and Edward Petrovsky, allege that they suffered severe injuries that include trauma to the brain, lacerations to the face that required stitches, multiple contusions on the body, disfigurement, internal bleeding, and other internal external injuries. And they're, you know, obviously trying to get $1 million in this when it comes to compensation for that. And I got to look at Rashi Rice and say, this is, you remember how you said you take full responsibility? This feels a lot like that full responsibility in part, right? Like the idea that you are going to have to make whole the victims of your poor decisions.
Exactly right. I've never heard anything bad about Rashid, but guess what? You made a bad decision.
Very bad decision.
And because of that, you are lucky, dude. You are so lucky. No one got hurt, paralyzed hurt. No one was killed. You're lucky you're not killed. You're lucky you could still play some football. He knows it too. Again, I don't know him, but I have never heard anything bad about him from these streets. And so with that in mind, he knows he's going to have to pay up some money. But I'm sure it's also the people who were injured. They know he's not Tyreek Hill. He don't got that kind of money, but he got enough. And I know this. This is kind of like a wake up call sometimes. You know, he hadn't had a history of bad decisions. But you know what? You just cannot do this ever again and be so grateful that, you know, it couldn't have been worse. And he's got good representations. He's saying the right thing. So, you know, hopefully everything settles itself out and this is not going to be something that gets dragged out.
Yeah. Well, saying the right thing is always one thing. For me, I'm always interested if you will actually follow
That's
up
right.
and do the right thing.
Not, and this is not drag it out.
This is going to be one of those instances where you try and make, you know, do the reparations necessary for your poor actions. In addition to that, it does remain to be seen whether the Chiefs or the NFL decide to do anything in regards to this when it comes to football, right? Keep him away from the team while the criminal charges are going forward. According to Pro Football Talk, the most likely options include maybe the league putting Rashee Rice on paid leave. You know how they do that thing. Or, you know,
I think
doing
he's
something
got
like that.
Really good representation, and therefore I think all those things are going to go like cookie cutter the way they should, especially if he takes care of the people who were hurt.
Yeah. So, I mean, maybe.
And I bet he won't drive cars like that no more.
Yeah, I do wonder if something the commissioner's exempt list pops up for him or whatever, what have you there. But I mean, still a lot of criminal things and, you know, those that have to be handled when it comes to the legal system. But
yeah, I don't see him getting locked up. I just see it being a situation where, okay, you can't do this no more. You're going to. Maybe your license gets suspended for a while, something like that.
Yeah. Reckless driving. Very reckless driving. And so Rashee Rice facing $1 million lawsuit in addition to
He's lucky it's not more than that. I'm serious.
Yeah.
Everything about this is like, I just shake my head like, it could have been so much worse.
It absolutely could have been a lot worse. Thankfully, it was not there. That. So get right here on 105 through the Fan. Thanks for hanging out with us on this Monday evening. We got you to midnight. Coming up next in our second hour, obviously we're coming up on the NFL draft. It's going to be a big-time QB class. How do all of the other NFL draft classes, when it comes to QBs, rank all the way back to 2000? We'll discuss it next on The Fan.
We have you covered.
For the Get Right on 105.3 The Fan.
Yes, indeed, it is the Get Right right here on 105.3 The Fan. My name is Reginald Adatula. That is the three-time Hall of Famer Chris Arnold.
Got you down.
We got Ross Lubinsky with us this evening. Thank you, sir, and thank you guys for rolling with us on a Monday evening. Oh, Chris Strong, you're there too. Shout out, my man. And also shout out to the Texas Rangers getting a 1-0 victory over the Detroit Tigers.
There you go.
In their first game of a four-game set. Rest of those are day games throughout the course of the rest of or throughout the majority of the rest of the week. Keep that locked right here on your home of the World Series champion Texas Rangers, 105.3 The Fan. Continuing to lead the AL West, your Texas Rangers. So shout out to also Michael Lorenzen, a nice first debut, I guess is the right word, for your Texas Rangers, for Michael Lorenzen, who was very happy to be in front of this defense.
There
yes,
you go.
Yes. Aided by that defense. I think he had, what was it, two or three double plays that happened during the course of this one. So very happy that you had this infield. And I guess that's also an opportunity to shout out Josh H. Smith, who's been very good both at the plate and then also in the field defensively. Man, it's been fun, even though you haven't seen a ton of offense. Jonah Heim getting a steal today, a couple of hits, and scored the winning run in this one. So,
oh, and one other note. Let's give also a shout out to Michael, because Jared had this stat of his 25 starts, 21 of them he went five innings last year. So in other words, you don't have to use a big bullpen when he's on the mound.
Yeah, and that's one of the things. When he signed, I got a lot more comfortable with the idea of this rotation. Now we haven't, Heaney hasn't found his footing just yet this season. Cody Bradford, who had started well, has gone on the injured list. There's some things that have shaken me a little bit.
That was strategic. Bradford was strategic.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, obviously you're playing 17 games in 17 days, exactly. Right? But they Bradford had a little, he had a little bit of injury situation, or a little bit of just something to make sure that he's
just
right.
Enough.
And so I'm super excited for Michael Lorenzen and what he can give your Texas Rangers. Let's talk a little bit about the NFL draft. We're 10 days away, if my counting is correct, from the first round of the NFL draft. And we're set to see a really good NFL quarterback draft class. At least that's what it appears to be. And I think we're looking at possibly four in the first five. I've seen
some people say the top three,
right?
Quarterbacks.
Top three probably going to be quarterbacks. Maybe we see four, five, six in the first round. Only God knows. So
can I say this real quick?
Yes, please.
There's no guarantee that they're all going to pan out, but because of the value, how much quarterbacks are valued.
Of course.
That's why there may be that many in the top five. In the first round, because seriously, it's like, I can't afford to pass this guy up.
That's how quarterbacks work in this league. And I mean, it has for a long time, which is why we turned to NFL.com, who has ranked the last 24 quarterback draft classes. So 877-881-1053, the Franklin Injury Attorney text line. Which classes do you think are the worst? Which ones do you think are the best on the 214? They say, C.A. Reggie, I'm really thinking this draft is going to be a top five quarterback draft like 1983.
Uh-oh.
You got Caleb Williams. You got Michael Penix. J.J. McCarthy, they say, will be a bust.
That's hype, man.
They say Jaden McDaniels from LSU. LSU. Mm-hmm. He's convinced that he will be Lamar 2.0 and better. Bo Nix is going to be a Tony Eason replica. Wow, so Jagon, you got a lot of takes there.
That 83 had some of the greatest quarterbacks of all time, Hall of Fame quarterbacks. The greatest quarterback class of all time is 83. So with that being said, I mean, slow your roll, because just because you're familiar with the names don't mean that they're all going to pan out.
Elway, Jim Kelly, Tony Eason, Ken O'Brien, Dan Marino, Tony Blackledge.
Yeah, okay. Even Blackledge got to go somewhere. Here's what's so crazy. Go back to Dak Prescott's draft class. He was a supplemental fourth round pick in 2016. Do you realize he is the only quarterback still with his original team? The only quarterback in that class. And he was a fourth round pick.
Yeah.
That's just giving you some perspective of how it just doesn't always work out the way you would think.
And funny enough, of those 24, the 2016 rather, I don't know, 2026 hasn't happened. The 2016 quarterback draft class in the NFL, ranked 11th. Jared Goff is up there. He's been a good quarterback, even though he's not with his original team.
Yeah.
Carson Wentz, Paxton Lynch.
By the way, for those who don't know, Carson Wentz is now backing up Patrick Mahomes.
Yes, he is. Yeah. Christian Hackenberg. Remember that name? Uh-huh. Jacoby Brissett still bouncing around as a backup. And then you mentioned Dak Prescott. Cardale Jones was drafted in the fourth. There's some guys on there. But, I mean, the main ones are going to be Jared Goff, Dak Prescott, in that draft class. Do you have any ideas? Let's have a little fun with this.
Okay.
Who would you look at, or what year would you maybe look at as possibly the worst since 2000 for quarterback draft?
The worst?
Mm-hmm. The absolute worst. Ranked 24 of the last 24.
2007.
Okay. Do you remember who was drafted in 07?
No, that's why I think it's the worst.
You're spot on, CA. 2007.
Really?
You were right on it.
The number one overall draft pick
went to the Oakland Raiders then. Jamarcus Russell.
Yes.
The other first round pick that year, Brady Quinn.
Yeah.
Very nice guy, however, did not last when it came to those Cleveland Browns. Second round, they had Kevin Kolb and John Beck.
I swear,
Drew Stanton.
2007, I was like, I can't remember a name out of that class.
One of the quarterbacks that was drafted in that draft, our friend Isaiah Stanback in the fourth round.
Look out. Turned out, you know what? He was a really good quarterback. Was it Oregon?
Somewhere in the Pacific. I think it's Washington.
Yeah, probably Washington.
Ooh, yep. He gonna be so mad at us for not knowing
he don't want an Emmy Award doing his final work.
He's not worried about what we
start. No, he's good. That's our guy.
He did go to Washington.
Yeah. I knew it was from the great Northwest. But yeah, he wasn't a great quarterback in the NFL. But he had a nice college career. Real nice.
Okay.
In fact, whenever he comes back, whenever like the Cowboys played up in Seattle, he went up there. I think it was Isaiah Stanback Day and stuff. So props to him.
Okay. So we got the worst one in. What do you think would be the best of the last 24 quarterback draft classes, going all the way back to 2000?
Give me, even though the jury's still halfway out, give me the Kyler Murray draft. Was that 2020? 2019?
That is 2019.
Okay, give me 2019.
Funny enough, 2019 ranks 14th.
Oh.
So Kyler Murray was the number one overall. Remember number six, the Giants got a little bit ambitious, drafted Daniel Jones.
Oh, Danny.
Dwayne Haskins, rest in peace, was drafted number 15 in that first round.
Back.
Those are your first round picks. Drew Lock got drafted. Will Greer, he ended up around here.
Here's the deal. All those names, notice they haven't done anything.
That's right.
But they were there. It's kind of like this year's draft. You don't know what the hell they're going to do. You just really don't. You just know the name.
You really don't, especially going in. But shout out to the 972 who points to the 2004 draft class, which is indeed
the number one.
Ranked number one. Because you remember Eli Manning goes number one overall there.
You know what? I almost said, where was Eli drafted?
Yeah, you had Eli Manning getting drafted. Seriously. Then, remember, you had Phillip Rivers, and those guys had a little bit of the trade situation in order to get Eli out of that place.
Archie said he ain't playing for the Chargers.
That's right.
And that's why Phillip Rivers wound up going there. And guess what? That forced Drew Brees to the New Orleans Saints.
It sure did. You figured out three whole situations, because I don't know. Is there a team out of those three that you felt was upset about the way that went?
None of them.
I think they all came out.
Phillip Rivers, great. Even though the Chargers didn't win a Super Bowl, Phillip Rivers set records.
He was incredible for them.
He was so solid. He also had a lot of kids.
He sure did. I don't think that speaks to his ability to quarterback, but that is a note that is worth bringing up. So you had those guys. Don't forget, Ben Roethlisberger was drafted in that one. Matt Schaub was drafted in the third round of that one. He ended up being very useful.
Yeah, Ben went to a couple of Super Bowls. Look out.
Those are the ones who were like the major ones. Obviously, J.P. Lawson was drafted. Luke McCown.
I almost said that because I was like, what was the Eli man? But there's a couple of tellers saying, I meant to, because I said 2020 and I was like, where Kyler was. What was the 2020 draft?
And 2020 lines up as second. Maybe you could arguably put this higher because Mr. Cigar Man himself, Joe Burrow.
Yep.
Tua Tagovailoa.
Yep.
Justin Herbert, who people still have a lot of love for.
Yep.
And Jordan Love. Those are all your first round picks.
Yep,
now, of course,
2020.
You're still in that time frame where guys are likely to still be with the teams, even if people aren't necessarily sold on them.
4 years.
But I think of those three, or of those four, three of them I feel like people are still completely big thumbs up on.
Yes.
And then the other one is Tua Tagovailoa, which I feel like is more still injury in like, between.
He can play. His injury situation before this past season, that's what scared people away from him.
Jalen Hurts was drafted in the third round of that one. That's another starting caliber quarterback. And then you have some other guys there.
I should have just said 2020, not Kyler Murray.
Ben DiNucci was drafted in 2020.
Who?
Ben DiNucci in the seventh round.
Hey, DiNucci with them caps.
But no, like that.
Upside
that,
down, Dallas.
And a I really good ben, draft class.
Where did Ben go? Did he just get traded? I want to say he was at Denver, but is he traded?
Who, Ben DiNucci?
Yeah, I want to say he's with
Oh, Denver. Like right now.
Right now.
Ooh, that is a good
look
question.
Look it up real quick. Yes, I literally should have just said 2020 and not even said Kyler Murray.
Ben DiNucci, Denver Broncos, as of right now.
I be remember a few things. I always say
you remember a lot of stuff. To be fair,
hell on Jeopardy, boy.
I'd love to see you on Jeopardy. I'm not gonna lie.
What is Ben DiNucci? An upside down cap.
That's right. the inventor of the Dallas cap that you see all the time. Someone mentioned the Jameis Winston, Marcus Mariota year that ends up coming in at 19. Oddly enough,
yeah, that didn't work at all
because Jameis and Marcus, neither of them really lasted in their starting places.
Both of them won the Heisman.
And then that was also a light year when you talk about drafted quarterbacks in general. Mm-hmm. Garrett Grayson, Sean Mannion were in the third round. Bryce Petty, Brett Hundley, Trevor Siemian. That is the entirety of the draft class. So, like, some of this is also just having a number of quarterbacks that are there.
Yeah.
Just because there's a number of them,
that don't mean they're all going
to
be good.
And that brings us back around to this one where there is a number of them. It doesn't mean that they're all going to be good, but I do think it gives you more of an opportunity for some of these guys to be good, especially when you consider there's a lot of guys at the high end. And as you mentioned starting this off, you're very correct that the quarterback position, the value of it dictates that I think it pushes value up and maybe players that aren't as good.
Because think about this. Just think about this, Tolos, and football fans. Nobody can name the backup quarterbacks. There's 32 teams. You can't even name all 32 starters. That's how weak the quarterback position is. That's why the ones that are top 15 on, they get paid big money.
Yeah.
There's not enough.
But at the very least,
but you have to take a chance.
And there's enough guys that are reasonably rated within that range to maybe possibly go first round. And we're talking about, like I said, maybe 5-6 guys. When you talk about, obviously, Caleb Williams, that a lot of people are looking at as potentially generational. Mm-hmm. Jaden McDaniel. Obviously, you have Drake May. Mm-hmm. And then J.J. McCarthy, Bo Nix, Michael Penix. Like, all of these guys possible to be very good at the very top of this. So I think this could be a really interesting draft class. I'm not certain that I would say that this is definitively going to be a top third, but I feel like you have a very good chance of this being a top third when we look back in maybe 4 or 5 seasons.
Speaking of quarterbacks, let me slide this in real quick.
Mm-hmm.
Next year, 2025, I don't know if you heard about this, Coach Prime, Deion Sanders.
Yes, sir.
You already know he says he is going to help his son pick the right team. They're not going to just go to whoever's got the whatever to pick, right? It's kind of like what a lot of people thought Caleb Williams' dad would do. It's like he would steer his quarterback. Archie Manning did it.
Yeah.
Deion says, I'm doing it. He has already announced the 6 teams that he will only let his son play for.
I am interested in this list because I want to get an idea of what his criteria is.
And it's not just Shadur, his son, the quarterback. It's also Travis Hunter, the two-way player, wide receiver, cornerback. He says they are a combo, not a combo package playing for the same team.
Sure.
But there's only 6 teams I would suggest even think about drafting either of these two teams.
Okay.
Two guys. They are the 49ers, the Commanders, the Ravens, the Falcons, the Cowboys, and one more. By the way, the ones I just mentioned, he played for all of those.
I'm pretty sure the connecting tissue is that he played in all these places, and that's not a great reason to go to some of these places because I know that Washington got new ownership, but I would like to wait and see.
And finally, there's one other team he mentioned that he did not play for. You might be surprised because they've got a young quarterback who got his big extension. He ain't going nowhere as far as I know.
Who is it?
The Cowboys' arch rival.
Oh, Philadelphia?
Yes. Jalen Hurts ain't going nowhere as far as you know, but he says, hey, that's on my list of the 6 teams that Shadur and Hunter should even consider.
Yeah, I'm very interested to see how much effort, how much weight he's able to, you know, force to get this
Archie
to be done.
It.
Yeah, Archie also was like, I think a different, you know, had a different level of weight in this, but maybe he can't, right? I'm not saying that he can't. I'm just interested. But also the 972 brings up a great question, which is, where's Travis Hunter's daddy at? Because apparently Dion thinks he is that. And then also I imagine Shiloh's over there like, hey, dog, I am actually your son. Hey,
not
buddy.
Yet. Not yet.
But yes.
We'll talk about 2026 with you.
But yeah, that's wow. Okay. Shout out to Deion Sanders. Best of luck to you in that regard. I hope that works out for you. Also, last year's draft, the 2023 quarterback draft, ranks 13th as of right now. Bryce Young, but CJ Stroud and Anthony Richardson still really a lot of upside on both of those guys as well. As you know, still have Will Levis, who's probably a starter in this play. So still some guys out there that could probably make some things work in that way when it comes to TBDs as well. So get right here on 105.3 The Fan as we just went around some of the best quarterback draft classes of the last 24 years, 10 days away from adding another draft class into it with the likes of Caleb Williams, Jaden Daniels, and then also Drake May, some other guys as well. So get right here on 105.3 The Fan. Coming up next, let's go around the association, talk about some of the play-in games that we have coming up this week. And then also, Team USA, get ready for Paris. Who's on the team? We'll discuss it next on The Fan.
Blasting out 100,000 watts of FM sports talk power.
Right here on 105.3 The Fan. My name's Reginald Atatula. That is a three-time Hall of Famer, Chris Arnold.
Got you there.
Thanks for rolling with us on this Monday evening on in the Metroplex on The Fan after your Texas Rangers got a 1-0 victory over the Detroit Tigers in game one of a four-game set that continues tomorrow. What is that first pitch? Is that 12:05, if I remember correctly? Is that right? All right. Ross's eyes tells me that he is not certain. He will give me accurate information because I told him to, and I'm technically, in this instance, his boss. He just nodded like, yeah, what are you going to do? Right. I was hoping that I might get a little bit of a rise out of him, but, you know, it's fine. It's 10:30. He's not worried about all that jive, that jibber-jabber.
You were exactly right, 12:10.
Very good. Excellent. 12:10, and that's a 12:10 first pitch for the remainder of the series. So Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, here on your home of the World Series champions.
As long as they're in Detroit.
That's right. 105 through The Fan. And hopefully they will get some more wins.
And by the way, Detroit's a really good team. They had a better record than the Rangers before the game started today.
A lot of teams did. All across the AL. The AL West is like a weird one looking at the standings because a whole bunch of teams right about at 500 or below compared to, like, you look around, like, AL West, or AL East, rather. Obviously, the Yankees are just, you know, pretty far ahead. As far ahead as you could be, like, what is it, 14 or so? That's not accurate. About 20 games into the season. I don't know how I just got rid of like six games there, but about 20 games into the season. But, you know.
Rangers were 8-8 till they won tonight.
Yeah.
Now they're 9-8.
And so
you were talking about those 500 teams.
A lot, yeah. The AL West got a whole bunch of teams looking to get this thing jump started. The Rangers obviously dealing with some injuries. The offense not necessarily humming in the way that we believe it to be capable of. The Astros, starting pitching, not where it needs to be at all. And is Josh Hader broken? I think Josh Hader might be broken. My baseball excitement is clearly coming through. We're supposed to be talking about NBA basketball. We are headed into, first of all, the play-in before Correct. We get to the playoffs. This week, we get to see that somewhat newfangled invention, the play-in. And we've seen this tournament over the last, what is it, three, four seasons and how it's worked. How have you felt about the play-in as a convention? Because
I'm glad you brought it up because in all seriousness, when they first created it, everybody was like, what? I've actually found out that people are keeping up with this thing and the end of the season and the play-in and the playoffs more so than just, oh, we just need a tank.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not top four in either conference, most fans would say, well, we just need a tank. We're not going to do a tank. Because the home team, if you're not top four, you're not going to get out of your first round. You're just going to tank. And now there's some drama because, uh-oh, we don't want to be in the play-in. Or, uh-oh, we had a chance to get in the play-in. Uh-oh, you don't want to be the pin. I mean, it's this second level of drama that there was never there before. So I'm like, wow. Lo and behold, it actually has intrigue to the end of the season. Because, again, it's not about, well, these eight teams are in position and everybody else is just go ahead and tank. We just watch. That's a strategy, you know, just tank. We just tank and see what kind of draft pick we can get. Well, guess what? The bad thing about tanking in the NBA is not the NFL draft. You got players drafted from all over the world. You know what they can do. And you got one and done. You might be talented, but you know what they can do. NFL, it's more exciting to follow because you know the college players. So with that being said, I actually have found mad respect for the playing.
Yeah, and it's actually, it's been very helpful in a season like this one where you have a conference in the West where literally 11 teams were 500 or better on their record. So in a more traditional standpoint of just the eight teams, and I understand you still want your postseason to be somewhat selective, somewhat exclusive, but in a season of that, you would have three teams would completely have no shot at the postseason while still putting together a really respectable season.
Yeah, including teams that normally, traditionally, would be at the top of the conference, like the Lakers and the Golden State Warriors. Guess what? Both of them in the play-in.
That's right. And with that being
the case, the Lakers, by the way, are undefeated in playoff and play-in history. They have never lost a play-in game.
And they have a matchup. They are one of four first matchups that we will see in the play-in. Obviously, the way that it works, if you're not familiar, yes, I'm going to try and do this over the air. I hope that this comes across, right?
Take your time.
You have your teams that are ranked or in the standings 7 through 10. Correct. On either conference. So we'll make this general in a conference. 7, 8, 9, 10, right? And so you do a mini tournament, but you're not just going to go worst standings, because in order to incentivize trying to be as good as possible, the 7 and 8 seed, if you win one game, you're immediately in, but then you have a little bit of a double elimination for them, right?
Yeah, basically, if you win 7 versus 8,
you become the 7 seed.
You're in the playoffs.
That's right.
But guess what? If you lose that game,
you still have an opportunity to get
in. You still play one more play-in game, and if you win that, then you get into the playoffs.
Right. So the loser of that 7-8 game will face the winner of the 9-10 game, obviously, to make it so that if you're one of those lower seeds, you have to really win your way in as opposed to just kind of being given it.
Yeah.
So
somebody's going to have to win two games other than the 7 versus 8 winner. Everybody else going to have to win two games just to get into the playoffs.
I'm not sure if I did that in a way that was very easy to understand, but regardless, you still have...
You know what? It's like...
I remember the first year when they were rolling it out, it was not easy for folks to understand. It's one of those things you just kind of got to see it.
But I was getting ready to say it. Say that. You have to see it, but let me tell you what's made this whole play-in and the playoffs visual. They actually have it like a bracket, like an NCAA March Madness bracket, and you can see where these teams are in the standings and who they have to play.
Yeah, you see the flow chart. And with that being the case, you will have four matchups to start the play-in. Obviously, there's the secondary game that we were discussing to determine who the 8 seed is. But you have four games. You have in the East, you'll have the 7-8 matchup between the Sixers and the Miami Heat, respectively. You'll have the 9-10 matchup in the East between the Bulls and the Hawks. And then in the West, you have the 7-8 matchup between the Pelicans and the Lakers, and the 9-10 matchup between the Kings and the Warriors. CA, of those four games, which one intrigues you the most?
I'm going to say the Bulls and the Hawks, because the Hawks, ironically, they always win their play-ins too.
Interesting.
Yeah. I know a lot of people looking for the Sixers and the Heat because you got Joel Embiid back and the Heat got, you know, Jimmy Buckets, and that could be interesting. But I'm really curious about the Hawks because I think this is the last year for Trae Young. He's going to wind up in San Antonio.
Yeah, that's interesting because it does feel like the Hawks have reached a place where if there's not some level of success, and even then, I don't know what level of success would be necessary, they're going to need to split up DeJounte Murray and Trae Young.
And here's the irony. If Trae Young goes to San Antonio, that's where they got Murray from.
Yeah.
They're just swapping teams.
Right. It's just been made abundantly clear that what they have there doesn't necessarily work in that way. So I think there is more intrigue there. However, I would have ranked that four of these four, because you're right, there is that intrigue there. I'm done thinking about the Bulls. The Hawks have not been interested, and they've ended the season really poorly. Three wins out of the last 10 games, 6 losses straight for the Hawks. Miss me with that. The one that I'm most interested in is the one that you mentioned earlier when you talk about Miami Heat, Philadelphia 76ers. This Sixers team, we saw Tyrese Maxey, local kid.
Oh, yeah.
Bloom into
South Garland zone.
That's right. You saw him bloom into a legitimate star in
probably
this league
most
this
improved
year.
Player award winner.
He could be. I don't really love that in the spirit of the most improved award, but we'll talk about that another time. I think Coby White has been really good in his role for the Bulls, but That feels a lot more like what I think about when I think of most improved player. But ultimately, I don't have a vote. I don't make the decision. So we'll see what that looks like. But yeah, you're right. Like the Sixers, we saw without Joel Embiid, Maxey had an opportunity to carry them
as best he could.
And once they got Joel Embiid back, they have been on a run. 8 straight wins to finish the season. Like they have looked dominant really quickly in a way that we had questions of when Joel Embiid gets back. He's going to have to ramp up. Is it going to look good? It has looked good right off the bat. And then the Miami Heat are notoriously just a team that turns it on in this time of year. We've seen them go from playing to the finals as well.
That's exactly why I didn't pick that series. I can't stand Miami.
Fair enough. I'm just saying. Fair enough. Well, you have an opportunity.
I just want Sixers just run through them.
Well, I think we have an opportunity to see that. And I am very interested in seeing that personally. Mm-hmm. Obviously, the other ones that are involved. So we talked about the 2 East ones, funny enough. Which of the ones in the West are you most interested in when we talk about Pelicans, Lakers, and then Kings, Warriors?
Kings, Warriors, a replay of last year's first round, and the Warriors knocked them out. Warriors are vested. They know what they're doing. They don't lose.
Yeah.
I'm more interested in the Lakers than the Pelicans because the Pelicans, they've just been collapsing, and the Lakers, they just keep on doing what they do.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it's kind of put like this. It's also Anthony Davis versus Zion.
Yeah.
And Anthony Davis forced his way out of New Orleans to play for the Lakers, and Zion fell into play. Zion had lost 25 pounds. And if Zion doesn't win this play-in, guess what? He will have been in New Orleans 5 years and never made a playoffs.
Yeah, this is the thing. I want to see eventually the Pelicans end up in the playoffs because I want to see Zion play on this big stage. I think we've forgotten how good that dude is and can be,
especially when he's away from the food.
And I want to see what that looks like. And this is a precursor. This would be a precursor to that. While also the Lakers low key have been very good. Their record has been bad because they're, you know, obviously working with some things prior, but they've been very good of late. So I'm interested in seeing that. So yeah, really interested in seeing what these play-in games look like.
The winner of that game automatically gets in.
And that starts tomorrow, right? Once we start seeing the play-in games get going.
6:30 TNT.
That's right. It'll be Lakers, Pelicans, Warriors, Kings. The Western Conference games will be tomorrow. The day after that is when we'll get the Eastern Conference play-in games. And then Thursday.
The typical Wednesday ESPN.
Yeah. And then, Friday, you'll get those second games to figure things out, make sure everything's together.
And what's that Maverick news?
Was that?
They play on Sunday.
That's right. Oh, I was like, was there more news? Did I miss something? I was scared for a second.
We're talking about
no.
schedules.
That's right. As we're talking about the schedule, on Sunday, the first round gets going for your Dallas Mavericks in Los Angeles at Crypto.com Arena against the Clippers in the first round. The trilogy will begin. Luka Doncic and Kyrie Irving versus Paul George and Kawhi Leonard.
You probably have 6 Hall of Famers playing in that game.
Probably.
You really do. Luka, Kyrie, down the road. You got Paul George. Kawhi Leonard, James Harden, and Russell Westbrook.
Absolutely.
That's
so
6 Hall of Famers.
Star-studded, and it will be a blast. Last time I saw, the Mavericks are slight betting favorites in this series.
Well, you know what? Shaq said it best. I don't know which Clippers team going to show up. I don't know what. I can't trust them.
And then also you have the Kawhi Leonard, knee.
And his knee and back.
I think that his kept him out at the end of the season.
Part of the season as well, so they're a little bit older, but they have a lot to play for because they all want to be in the new building. Only Kawhi had his contract extended.
Yeah, so it'll be very interesting to see how that comes through and what happens there. As we,
I like the Mavericks in this thing.
I don't blame
I'm totally
you. I do
biased,
too,
but I do.
I'm glad that you acknowledge that.
But I got receipts from the last 2 months. I can say that with my chest out.
That's
I
right.
I like the Mavericks.
That's
much
right.
Better than the Clippers.
How about this? Let's get this in real quick because the U.S. Basketball, U.S. Basketball Federation has put together the basketball, or Team USA, I guess you should say, put together the Olympic team. They're finalizing the roster for the Olympics in Paris 2024. Remember, Grant Hill organizes that, and the team includes LeBron James, Stephen Curry, and what I believe is his first Olympics. Olympic action.
Hurt. Always was hurt those years.
Kevin Durant, Joel Embiid, if you don't remember. Mm-hmm. Joel Embiid had an opportunity early last year to decide what team he wanted to play for, his native Cameroon. France.
Which would have been France, yeah. Or, oh, yeah, yeah, Cameroon and France, yeah.
Or the United States, and he picked the United States, which just seems unfair. So you'll join, those guys will join Anthony Davis, Devin Booker, Anthony Edwards, Jason Tatum, Drew Holiday, Bam Adebayo, and Tyrese Halliburton. That thing seems stacked, buddy.
And they've got one open spot available. They're not saying who it's going to be because guess what? There's a lot of people it could be. But if you're a Maverick fan, you should be miffed. No, Luke, not Luka. Talk about Kyrie.
Mm.
Why is Kyrie not on that list?
I don't know. That's an interesting idea because, I mean, you look at kind of point guard types and you have Steph Curry there.
Tyrese Halliburton. That's it.
Booker and Edwards are shooters. Somewhat close. They handle the basketball, but they're more shooting guards shooters. If you consider them. Drew Holiday, also another
he's a shooter.
Kind of point guard type.
He's a perimeter.
But, yeah, you have an opportunity to maybe add. That could be interesting to see. But as of right now, that team is already
it's loaded.
A problem
and
to
again,
deal with.
There's one spot available, and they did that on purpose for the intrigue because you could have Zion. I could go down the list. You could have named some of these guys who are not. Paul George said, I would want to play if they asked me to. And he wasn't mentioned.
So it'll be interesting to see who they rounded out with. But this looks like a pretty solid team to go out there and compete for a gold medal to satiate what will be, I'm sure, unreasonable expectations for the team.
Oh, yeah.
As we always have. We want you to go out there and win every game by 50.
But understand this. The world has caught up with the United States. Some of the best. In fact, just look at the MVPs over the last few years. All foreign born.
Yeah.
Giannis.
Jokic, yeah, which is why it was a coup to get Joel Embiid. Because also one thing you notice, not a lot of size. You do have Anthony Davis, but you add Joel Embiid, and that changes the size when it comes to the international game for Team USA. That's Around the Association here on the Get Right on 105.3 The Fan. Coming up next, as we typically do, and we shifted it back just an hour. Let's do a little sharing time.
Yeah, let's do that.
We'll do it next on The Fan.
Coming up on the next KNC Masterpiece. Let's puck around and find.
the Get Right right here on 105.3 The Fan. Reginald Dattatulli here with you alongside the three-time Hall of Famer Chris Hong.
Got you down.
Thanks for rolling with us on this Monday evening in the Metroplex. As I received a text message from a friend of mine and a friend of ours, actually, and who I, in part, wanted to do a little sharing time about. As we do that right now on The Fan, we typically do that here on the Get Right, do a little sharing time, just talk about what we've had on our minds, maybe something that we read, something that we found interesting, or maybe something that we did as myself, you, Alec Medford joined us as well on the for the Get Right, our dinner for the Sandlot charity. Jared Sandler, our colleague and friend here at 105 Through The Fan. He has a charity event that you should, you, I, if you listen to the station, you have absolutely heard about
it. It's amazing.
He does the Swing for the Cause charity event. And during the course of that, he auctions off a lot of sports memorabilia and experiences. And some of those experiences that happen, or I guess one of them at least, is a opportunity to have dinner or in this instance, lunch with the Get Right. And so it, in this instance, it was myself, CA, and Alec Medford as a representative.
Why y'all leave out Blake?
All right, so what had happened was, okay, no, but for real, what had happened was the organization that happened for this dinner happened well before. Blake had just come on to the station.
Yeah, he's still a phenom.
Didn't know how all of this was working out.
Right.
And so we ended up going with.
He was popping on.
Yeah, the folks that we had known at that point by the time the dinner came around, Blake has been a valued part of this show. And so one thing you could guarantee next time it comes around, Blake will be at the dinner. But the winner of the dinner.
Somebody bring him some leftovers because, you know, he's a struggling just out of college.
I don't know. He'd be shopping at Whole Foods and, you know. Yeah,
Sephora.
Yeah, Sephora. He act like he got money. I don't know if he got money. I'm not in that man's bank account. Don't call me Ipe Mizuhara, right? But it does seem like he got a little money. He's fine right now. But, yeah, so we had this dinner on Sunday. It was yesterday, right?
It wasn't even a dinner. It was like a brunch.
Yeah, it was basically a brunch because we had it early in the afternoon. Rangers baseball was on.
1 o'clock in the afternoon.
We were about to get some Mavs basketball. Was it Mavs basketball you want to watch? No, but it was Mavs basketball nonetheless. But we were able to hang out with our friend Rachel, who is a big-time Tolo, big-time Rangers fan. Mm-hmm. And the reason why I brought her up, she actually just sent me a text.
Hey, Rachel.
Of what we were talking about, which were the black Texas Rangers jerseys with the gold accents, gold lettering. And these things are gorgeous. She got her an Adolis Garcia.
Look out.
And an Evan Carter.
She's got all the Rangers gear.
But someone says, nah, CA, Blake is bougie. He doesn't need scraps. But yeah, no, we had fun. We went to the porch in Knox Henderson.
Yep.
And I had a lot of fun with it, man. It was
good
fun.
Food too.
Yeah, really good food. It did make me want to ask
that. By the way, Blake wouldn't go there because it's not bougie food. I'm kidding. I'm going off of the text.
I was like,
Red.
I don't know. I feel like it was.
Blake is not bougie. That food was, it was bigger. Like homemade, it's like being on the porch, but it's like, man, that was some good stuff.
Fair enough.
They had a little bit of anything you want.
From the 214, Blake here, too busy at Coachella on my private jet. That's hilarious.
It is.
It's not actually Blake for those listening.
And by the way,
that is hilarious.
That was Blake flying the private plane at Coachella that had Cowboy Carter banner flying over the sky. That was him driving it.
We hung out, and one of the things you mentioned, it was brunch. They had the brunch menu, and I looked at the brunch menu, and they had, I kid you not, bread pudding French toast.
Mm-hmm.
And if anybody knows me well enough, they know bread pudding is a thing that I absolutely love. Blame my mom for that. It's her favorite dessert. It became my favorite dessert, just how that happens. And that made me ask, and I asked you guys at the table too, do you have like an item where if you see it on the menu, just got to get it? Like it gets ordered.
It is
because for me it's bread pudding.
It's apple pie and I'm comparing the apple pies. I want it because I always want. Is the apple pie better than the other place that I go to? Mm-hmm. Or another? I'm always comparing apple pie. I love apple pie for my dessert. Although I do also love chocolate cake, but if there's apple pie on the menu, sight unseen or taste unseen, I will try to compare it. Although I'm hesitant in New York to get the apple pie. Because it's cold under a glass.
That's a good point.
It drives me crazy. They just do not believe in having warm or hot apple pie.
That's.
It drives me crazy.
That's so true.
And they're like, warm it up And they're like, they put a match on it. I'm like, no.
I want hot apple pie and then put some ice cream on top.
Put some ice cream on top of it. And I like apple cobbler, apple everything. Just name the all different kinds of apple pie. I have to try it.
Right now, do you have the place in your mind that has the best apple pie? Because it sounds like you keep a running ranking.
Yeah, but you know.
You don't have to tell me where it is, but I imagine that you're like, yeah, number one is so-and-so place. Number two is this place, but only on Fridays because that's when they make it fresh. Number three, like, I feels like that's how you have it.
There's this place, this Mexican restaurant that's about to close down.
See?
It's a legendary place called Casa Rosa. It was off of Inwood, and then they moved it and reopened it. But they're getting ready to close it down next month. And they have a Mexican apple pie.
Ooh.
That they put a flame on it. When they bring it out.
Oh, ooh, that's always flaming. Fun. The fancy tricks.
And then they got that ice cream on top. And like, ooh, that stuff's different and it's delicious. Also, there was a apple pie in Oklahoma where they had some kind of bourbon drizzle on it.
Mm, that sounds good. Mm-hmm. I shout out to the 214. I agree with you. Peach cobbler is also one of those.
Yep.
If you have peach cobbler, got to try it. And they also mentioned mac and cheese. Sorry to the other side. Mac and cheese is a real dangerous proposition, though.
Got to be good.
Mac and cheese can easily not be great. Exactly. Well, also, it could easily be great.
Really good. If it has several cheeses on it, maybe two or three cheeses. By the way, for lunch I had at the porch, I had a 4-cheese grilled cheese sandwich with tomato soup.
It looked really good.
It was really good.
Yeah, it looked solid.
It was like on Texas toast, and it was crispy, and it wasn't burnt, but it's crispy, and the cheesy was gooey, and that tomato soup was on point. You just dipped that grilled cheese sandwich in that tomato soup. That's the way you're supposed to do it.
So, shout out to Miss Kim, who said, leave my child alone. I raised him well.
Yeah, Kim, we know you're not bougie.
That is Blake's mom, mm-hmm. who is a avid tolo, yes, and wonderful person. But yeah, one of the things for me that was also funny was because...
Hey, Miss Kim, make Blake take you to the porch.
That's right.
You will love it.
It was a fantastic place to get food. Yeah, right off Knox Henderson. Right off 75. You're right. What was also weird for me personally, because, you know, we all got entrees and then they were like, would you like dessert? Well, my entree was bread pudding French toast. I mean, there was whipped cream all over it. I felt like I had already eaten dessert. And so for me, I feel like I did this reversed, mm-hmm. where everybody else was like, yeah, give me a brownie or like a cake or something. I was like, give me brisket tacos, because I looked at the menu. And while I was looking at the menu, I was like, there's multiple things that I want. Once I got one of the things, I was like, I'm not getting dessert, so I might as well get another thing that I want. So my dessert was brisket tacos. Is that weird? They were good. They were very good. It was just enough. But I also, one of the things that I realized as well, and I mean, this happens anytime that you have dinner where you're like, you're expecting to have more conversation than eating, is I have to realize I have to order less food than I normally would, because like, it's not like I'm here to eat. I'm here to like talk and engage while also having a little bit of food. It almost like my objective has to change. And I had enough food where I was like, I probably need to eat more than I talk right now to make sure, because you guys were eating like a cake or a brownie. I had 3 brisket tacos that I had to get down in the same time frame. And so I hope that it was not very evident that I was like, I got to eat this real quick. So I'm still present in the, because I'm somebody who I'm like, I'm really focused on, this person paid money to hang out, so I want to make that worthwhile.
Well, check this out, Ross. Every time they ask, he was eating his dessert, his brisket tacos, they said, so, Reg, what do you think? He go, No, I'm kidding.
It was a fun time. Mm-hmm. Enjoyed the porch. Shout out to our friend Rachel, who also said, homemade apple crisp. Has CA had that?
Yes. I love homemade apple crisp. I told you, apple pie, apple desserts, I'm an appleholic.
Okay, I like that. I like that. I mean, I feel like we have the saying, as American as apple pie. I feel like that
I know how to make an apple pie from scratch, and I made it for G-Bag in Oxnard 1 year. But I've been making apple pie since I was a little boy, because in our backyard, we had an apple tree, a cherry tree, and a peach tree. And my two sisters, one of them had a peach tree and a cherry tree. I had the apple tree, and I would pick my own apples, and my grandma showed me how to make some apple pie from scratch, including the dough. And I made it for G-Bag one night. They couldn't believe it. They couldn't believe how it was really, really good.
They call you CA Appleseed on the
for
text
real?
Line.
I appreciate that.
214, I'm with you there as well. It's probably a problem that I agree with all of these. I should probably have like an answer as opposed to 17 of them. They say cheesecake. Doesn't matter where I'm at or if I or where when I go, if I see it, I have to order it. Cheesecake is a great answer, especially when you get like some strawberry cheesecake or like just a fancified cheesecake. Always a good way to go.
Cheesecake Factory.
Cheesecake Factory. Look,
there you go.
People joke about the Cheesecake Factory. Handles his business. It handles up. You know what I mean? It handles up. So, again, thank you to our friend Rachel.
And the porch. The whole staff was great.
Was fantastic. And, of course, as always, it's wonderful to be able to do this. Now, I act like I'm doing heavy lifting, right? I had to have fun and eat food. It was a worthy cause. But it was a very worthy cause to support the Sandlot charity, the great work that Jared and all of the other people involved with it, because it's not just Jared. It's a team effort. And the work that they're able to do to make sure that, youth get active, especially youth with special needs that don't often have things available to them. Exactly. So always good to shout out the Sandlot Charity. And if you want to support them, always, reach out Sandlot Charity and hit Jared Sandler up on Twitter. He loves talking about these things. So it was very fun. Someone else said German chocolate cake. That's one that I will not agree on. Thank you for sending that in.
I know. I like chocolate cake, but not German. I'm not a coconut guy. I cannot. Don't get me wrong. I just cannot handle
Yeah, coconut is not my favorite flavor. I'm not going to hate it, but I'm also not going to enjoy it as much as anything
else. I drink coconut oil every morning.
You drink coconut oil?
In a shot glass. It's part of my diet. You got to look up the
health benefits?
Yeah, MCT oil. It's coconut oil.
Okay. CA drop a game. You're wondering why CA is...
I'm in shape. I stay in shape.
It's the coconut oil. Look at that. Drop a game.
And apple cider vinegar.
You got to listen to the Get Right late at night to get your tips from the three-time Hall of Famer and the health man himself, Chris Arnold. Thanks for hanging out with us on the Get Right right here on 105.3 The Fan. Coming up next, final hour of the program begins with us getting you your headlines on this Monday evening. We'll do it next on The Fan. We'll be right back.
time for the Get Right on 105.3 The Fan.
Final hour of the Get Right here on this Monday evening in the Metroplex. My name's Reginald Atatula. That is the three-time Hall of Famer, Chris Arnold.
Got you down.
Thanks for rolling with us. Ross Lubinsky on the ones and twos. And you. Oh, he curtsied. That was unexpected. Man, that's what happens when the show goes after 11 all the way to midnight. You get wild things talking about peach cobbler, ice cream, German chocolate cake, curtsies, all sorts of weird stuff happen after 11 here on the Get Right. But, you know, we're happy to do it, especially as we had to make a little bit of way for your Texas Rangers. And that's how we will begin getting your headlines on this evening. Texas Rangers had a East Coast game or Eastern time zone game as they were up in Detroit, Michigan. And so that kind of threw off the schedule a little off than what typically happens. So they get started about 5:40 thereabouts earlier today. And when they get finished, the scoreboard reads 1-0 in favor of the good guys, 1-0 in favor of the Texas Rangers. They get a win that pushes them to 9-8. Marcus Semien with the lone RBI. Yes, it was he hits it to what was a fielder's choice, ultimately, correct? And you get the out at second. Actually,
he ran it out.
We could play that audio, can we? It's the home of the Texas Rangers. Yeah, what am I doing? So give me cut number 11. Is that it? This is our guy, Matt Hicks, giving you the lay of the land of the one run in this game.
So here's Semien now with the bases loaded and nobody out. Nothing the score. Pitch to Marcus, his bounce deep in the hole at short. Baez has it. To second for one, on to first, not in time. Heim scores, Semien safe at first on the fielder's choice. He picks up his 15th RBI, and the Rangers strike first and lead 1-0.
So yeah, that was the deciding run in the game. Big shouts out to Marcus Semien, who had a solid solid evening, I should say, leading off, obviously getting that run. Jonah Heim himself,
he's
also solid in this.
I give him the credit right there because he got two hits and he scored the game-winning run, and by the way, this is the first shutout of the season for your Texas Rangers.
It's wild to think about it that way, but it was. And I guess some of that credit also needs to be given to this gentleman right here on the bump to start this one.
2-2, swing and a miss, and he struck him out. Got him with a changeup down there. And so, well, that's another way to do it. You're not going to get two outs, but the runners don't move. Lorenzen records his fourth strikeout.
He was solid.
He was solid. A lot of ground outs as well, as that's typically what he does. I believe he induced three double plays in the course of this game.
Uh-huh.
Solid work, good start for him in his debut as a Texas Ranger. Michael Lorenzen giving you a little bit of something for your starting rotation.
Yeah, three hits, walked five, four strikeouts. And this is against his former team, by the way. And how much does he cost the Rangers? 1 year, $4.5 million. This is a guy that pitched a no-hitter last year. And by the way, he was playing for the Tigers before the All-Star game last year, before he's traded to the Phillies. He was playing for the Phillies. He played for the Tigers first.
Yeah.
So I'm just glad we got him. This is his first start for the Rangers.
I am too. It was incredibly helpful to see, especially after the rehab starts weren't exactly what you wanted, but comes up, gets the job done, thanks his defense behind him and the relievers who came in, including Kirby Yates. Eight pitches in the final frame to put this thing away. So, I mean,
he's
incredible
work. Steal of a guy that they got, because when he was pitching for the Padres, Yates had, like, I think, I want to say his hit like 20, 40-something saves 1 year. I was like, what? But he did.
Yeah, man. The veteran bullpen guys that you had, David Robertson was also good.
Yeah,
he handled the eighth. And Jose Leclerc solid in the sixth and seventh. He gave you two innings of work, and it feels like this is the place where you need to use him in the, seventh innings thereabout.
He only had one base runner in those two innings. And this is Leclerc, who's been struggling this year.
But that's the thing about Leclerc, and it's something that we know, and I guess we just had to get to that place where you give him the opportunity. Bochy knows best, right? He closed at the end of the season. You give him the opportunity to close just as a matter of fairness. But it seems obvious when you have him in situations that aren't as high leverage, where he can't get in his head, he has the stuff to get it done, and he showed that again today. 1-0, the score in favor of your Rangers. They moved to 9-8, and they have three more games against the Detroit Tigers, all of them day games. All of them can be heard right here on 105.3 The Fan.
On the mound tomorrow, John Gray looking for his first win, and I'm looking for John Gray from spring training. That's the guy I've been waiting on.
Need it, because if there's going to be a level of stability, especially in this rotation, John Gray being good, being the good version of John Gray is going to be helpful. Obviously, last time out, I was encouraged that slider was looking like he could control it a little bit better. I'd like to see that progress tomorrow in that day game.
Rangers move up to 9-8. They were 8-8, still first place in the American League West. Detroit is now 9-7.
That is correct.
Detroit still has a slightly better record than the Rangers, but we ain't done with them yet.
We are not done with them yet. As we continue to get you your headlines on this evening, we mentioned earlier today, or earlier in the program, it was mentioned earlier today that CeeDee Lamb and Micah Parsons, neither of them are participants today in the first day of the, what do we call that? Voluntary off-season conditioning.
Which means strength and conditioning, no hitting, no pads and helmets, no nothing, just lifting weights and running some laps.
There you go. And so
Micah Parsons is like, I got other things going on in my life, and see these people like, he ain't showing up, he ain't got no contract.
Yeah, they don't have that contract. Justin Jefferson in the same boat for the Vikings.
By the way, Dak did show up.
Yes, he did.
Dak Prescott did show up.
Leader guy. Dak Prescott, leader guy.
And by the way, I'm telling y'all, keep an eye. I was saying this earlier in the show. Keep an eye on CD, what happens with the OTAs. And just want to refresh Cowboy fans' memories. Zach Martin had to miss part of summer training camp in Oxnard. Training camp in Oxnard because the Cowboys had kind of verbally said, yeah, we're going to take care of you because he's like, him and his agent's like, wait a minute, I'm not one of the top players paid in my position. Y'all know what I do. And I've been giving y'all working my contract around to give y'all cap space. Where my money? He had to not show up. But keep an eye on CD's situation because this is what happens. And the OTAs, instead of quote unquote holding out, they have this thing called holding in. And Zach Martin did this when he was in Frisco. He was there in the building, but he wasn't doing no pads and he wasn't participating in any kind of practice. He was just in the building so they couldn't find him.
Yeah.
$101,000, which they could find you. So watch CeeDee Lamb be in the building if they don't take care of his contract as they hold in. TJ Watt did the same thing with Pittsburgh.
Yeah, that's once we get to mandatory.
Exactly. And that's the OTAs and the mini camps. And
there you go. And so
training camp.
But this is the first step. The voluntary, and he did not show up for
that. I chose not to volunteer.
That's right. As we continue on this Monday,
I'm not a volunteer army guy.
I did want to, shout out the Stars who clinched the division over the weekend. Saturday, they get a win, and they continued to push for the President's Trophy. That push is over as today, the New York Rangers. They hosted the Ottawa Senators in New York, and they handled business. 4-0 was the score. So the Rangers win the President's Trophy for this season. I imagine there's actually a lot of Stars that are breathing a sigh of relief in some ways because there is that correlation between President's Trophy winners not winning the Stanley Cup since, I think, 2012, 2013, that season. And so if you have that level of superstition, for lack of a better word, or you had that level of concern, that does not exist for you, as the Rangers will be the ones to hoist that award. Your Stars, though, still a very good hockey team. One more game to be played. I believe that's Wednesday when it comes to the regular season. And then they will host the Blues. And then we're off to the races in the postseason with a team that seems like they have really adjusted for, kind of the defensive, I don't know if, the lacks that they had defensively. They've been playing very well. I'm super excited to see the Stanley Cup playoff run that these Stars will put together. Now that it basically feels like the regular season things are done with, although they still have one more game to go.
I want to see how much we see of Robertson this year in the Stanley Cup playoff.
Yeah, it'll be interesting.
He didn't do that much last year.
I mean, he did stuff.
He did less than we thought he would do.
Right, especially
I'm
because
not saying he didn't do anything.
Right, right, right.
It's just like, where is he? He didn't ghost us, but he wasn't as productive as he had been in the regular season.
Because that regular season was an insane production season. He's had a very good season still.
Are you saying his legs got tired? He's too young.
I don't know if that's necessarily what it was, but I think the postseason production, which honestly still was not, as you mentioned, was not as good as we were expecting. I think that he has an opportunity now, having gone through that, maybe to be able to adjust to that. And hopefully
we also have some depth.
Absolutely.
In goal.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So I'm super excited to see what this run will provide for your Dallas Stars. As we continue,
you want to give mention that Mavericks thing since the
yeah,
talking about schedules?
Yeah, we're talking about schedules, and the schedule is half set for your Dallas Mavericks, as obviously we knew midway through last week that the Mavericks would be facing off against the Clippers in the first round. We know the day that that series will start. It'll be Sunday. April 21st. The first round series against the Los Angeles Clippers will begin in LA, Crypto.com Arena. That'll be game one. We don't know what time. The time is still to be determined.
I bet it won't be noon.
I have a strong feeling that you're right in that regard, right? Especially on the West Coast. I imagine we get a decently late game. And then it's a marquee one. A lot of stars in this one, as you mentioned. Mm-hmm. Could be probably six Hall of Famers in the course of this game. And so I imagine that the NBA wants to put this in a very visible place. So,
and it's a rematch.
Yes,
this is the third time the Mavericks and the Clippers have played each other in the first round in the playoffs. The Clippers have won both series, but as a friend of mine, Jonathan, put it, he said, this is destiny. It's just like when the Mavericks finally beat the Phoenix Suns. Remember, when they played Phoenix Suns in the playoffs, the Phoenix Suns were defending Western Conference champions, had just come out of the finals where they had lost to the Milwaukee Bucks the year before, and they had beaten the Mavericks in Phoenix 8 years in a row. Not eight times, 8 years in a row. And in that playoff series, in the semifinals, the Mavericks lost every game in Phoenix till game seven, where they beat the F out of them.
They sure did. I'm glad that censorship happened there.
I learned.
Super excited to see that one get going. We got a little bit of week. We still got some playing games that will start tomorrow. Mm-hmm. You'll have the Western Conference iterations of those playing games tomorrow, and then the Eastern Conference the day after on Wednesday. So we got a little bit of basketball. If you get a little jittery in that regard, that will still happen during the course of the week, and then we'll get to the nitty gritty. Your Mavs come weekend.
By the way, if you're trying to keep up with how to find these playoff games, it's real simple. TNT always has the West. ESPN always has the East. Up until the finals. I'm talking about the play-in. The play-in. Mm-hmm. That's how you find out, okay, what night is TNT? Tuesday. What night is ESPN? Wednesday or Friday. I mean, Thursday and Tuesday is TNT.
And this is the thing. I love this time of year, but I also kind of hate it. And look, this is just me being privileged. I understand my job is in sports. I get it. But this is the time of year when your job is to plop down in front of this TV every night around 6 o'clock and stay there until 11 because you're literally, it's just going to be basketball every night from, about Saturday on, you will have basketball every night.
And to show you how this thing goes, in the first round, because of TV matchups, these first round matchups might go 2 weeks. It may not be like, okay, the Mavericks play on Sunday, they'll play on Tuesday. No, they might make it to Wednesday or Thursday or something. You just don't know.
And that's just considering the NBA side of it. We still got the hockey side of this as well. We talk about the Stanley Cup playoffs. This is a time of year where it is incredible. It could wear you down. So strap in, make sure you've got your endurance together, maybe get you some level of coffee or something to keep you stimulated to keep going.
Mm-hmm.
Strap in, man. Playoff.
And
love
by the
it.
Way, the NBA finals will begin June 6th. And if there's a game 7, it'll be June 23rd. This is April, y'all.
Yes.
This is April 15th.
Yes, it is. And
did you get your taxes in?
I got my taxes in last week, which is the latest that I have done it in a long time. Letting it get into April, I had a little bit of shame for that, but I did get it done. As
if they're paying
your civic
you don't have to get it to the 15th. They don't care when you turn it in.
That's
you
right.
Get money back.
That's right. As we continue to get you your headlines, shout out to the Dallas Stars, the Dallas Wings, a different team with green on them. Who participated in the WNBA draft. That happened earlier today.
They had two first-round picks in the top 10.
They sure did. And obviously, number one overall pick was indeed Caitlin Clark. She'll play in Indiana. Mm-hmm. Obviously, there's a lot of people already circling that date when the Fever come to Arlington to face off against the Dallas Wings. I'll have to get that date again. It's kind of incredible that I don't remember it, to be completely honest. Cameron Brink goes to the Sparks. Also, an interesting note when it comes to the draft, names that you will know, Camila Cardoso, the big 6'7 center from Brazil who played at South Carolina. She, along with Angel Reese, the big who played at LSU, both going to be playing for the Chicago Sky, if that interests anybody. And your Dallas Wings got two first-round picks, one of them J.C. Sheldon, who's a point guard from Ohio State, got a nice handle, got a shot to her. played some good defense. Definitely something that the Wings needed, as well as Carla Leite. I definitely didn't say that right. She's French. That's probably going to be more of a draft and stash situation. But that was, those were the first two of the three picks that they ultimately selected. I believe the other one was a third rounder, Ashley Owusu from yes. Penn State.
By the way, here's the date. The Indiana Fever will be at College Park Center in Arlington to take on the Wings in a preseason game first.
Oh,
it's here before you know it. It'll be on May 3rd.
Okay, so that's
11:30 a.m. Caitlin Clark comes to DFW.
A Friday at 11? Okay, I don't know if I'll be. I was about to say I'm gonna make it out there.
Not Saturday. It seemed like it's.
You said
May the 3rd.
May the 3rd.
Yeah, May the 3rd, 11:30 a.m. It's a preseason game.
That's a Friday. Okay, all right. Okay, I might not be able to make that one like I thought
it's
I would.
It's a Friday.
My calendar might be bootleg. It's possible.
I'm going to have to check that.
Yeah, that's right.
They have an 11:30
double
game
check
on
me.
A Friday.
We were talking earlier about the USA basketball, Team USA, getting ready for the Paris Olympics mm-hmm. coming up this summer. They are finalizing their roster. One spot remains.
It is a Friday. My goodness.
Yeah.
I know what it is.
What's that?
Cinco de Mayo weekend.
Ah, that's right. There you go.
There will be people there.
But yes, Team USA will have LeBron James, Kevin Durant, Steph Curry, Joel Embiid. Don't forget, he is going to play for the Americans. Jason Tatum, Devin Booker, Drew Holiday, Anthony Davis, Bam Adebayo, Anthony Edwards, Tyrese Halliburton. One spot remains, and I think the expectation is that the favorite right now is Kawhi Leonard. But you were bringing up another person who's getting snubbed in this.
Yeah. Dallas Maverick fans should get kind of mad. No, I'm not talking about Luka. He's playing for Slovenia. Talking about Kyrie. How in the world is Kyrie's name not even mentioned in possible filling in that last spot? I'm miffed. I don't understand it. By the way, I did find out.
When was the last time that Kyrie participated with Team USA?
I have to look that up. But I did look up when the Indiana Fever will be at College Park in Arlington.
I appreciate your intrepid reporting.
Yes. You have to wait all the way to September.
Oh, wow.
Sunday.
Late in the season.
Yes. Sunday. September, are you ready for this?
Yes.
Sunday, September 1st.
Okay.
At 3 p.m. That's when you, and that's another holiday. It's like, isn't that like Labor Day weekend?
I don't know. I live my life about 2 weeks ahead. I know about the next 2 weeks thereabouts.
Well,
and
the
after
next
that,
2 weeks, you go see Caitlin Clark, who's famous now from Saturday Night Live, Friday to May the 2nd. At 11:30.
Very good. All right. I'll see about if I can get out there for that one. But there you go. Those are some of the things that are happening when it comes to headlines around the Metroplex and the sports world. Did I miss anything all that important? Oh, I should let you know that Max Scherzer threw two live batters today. Obviously, the place where he won his first Cy Young up in Detroit is where they are right now. He threw to live batters, live BP, I believe 25 pitches. Was what it was. He's next in line to throw a 40-pitch live session on Friday, and they're thinking that he could return, quote, sometime Uh-oh. In May. So we're getting closer and closer to the idea of Max Scherzer possibly returning for your Texas Rangers. Another hopeful sign when it comes to helping out the Texas Rangers in their attempt to run it back.
Kyrie Irving played for Team USA in the 2016 Olympics in Rio de Janeiro.
Okay.
There you go.
All right. So, I mean, he's clearly been the program, and I don't know. Well, it'll be interesting. I imagine that he would want to play, but we'll see. We'll see how this ultimately mm-hmm. plays out for the 2024 Team USA team headed to the Paris Olympics. There you go. Some headlines on this Monday evening right here on your home of the Cowboys and Texas Rangers, who won the World Series, by the way. 105.3 The Fan. It's the Get right here on 105.3 The Fan. Coming up next, as we typically do when CA is in the house, let's get you some CA Stories Confidential.
We've got an update. We got an update on, did Tony Braxton break up the 3Js? I've been telling y'all the truth. I'm going to redouble down on this, but there's a new twist. Ooh. Coming up next on 105.3 The Fan.
The latest from the star in Frisco, as well as...
Get right here on 105.3 The Fan. Reginald Dattatula here with you alongside the three-time Hall of Famer Chris Arnold.
Got you down.
Thanks for rolling with us on this Monday evening in the DF Dub. We got you for just another maybe about half hour on the evening, headed into a Tuesday.
On a Tuesday.
In the Metroplex.
On a Tuesday.
Having fun after your Rangers got a 1-0 win earlier this evening against the Detroit Tigers in Detroit. And shout out to Marcus Semien for getting the lone RBI, the deciding factor, and obviously Jonah Heim for crossing the plate to get your guys, the good guys, the win. They'll be back at it tomorrow, midday, 12:10, first pitch here on 105.3 The Fan. But I don't want to waste any time. I'm here with the man himself, Chris Arnold. Let's get some CA stories, confidential.
Appreciate you, Reg. Appreciate you, Ross. And more importantly, appreciate all the Tolos. There's no me without you. Let me share some of these stories from, man, I've had just the most interesting career. Just crazy stuff has happened over the years. And I want to talk about conspiracy theories.
Oh.
And I want to talk about confirmation bias.
Yes.
It's an amazing thing. I'm going to start off by saying there are people to this day. I'm going to talk about two conspiracy theories.
Okay.
The first one is there are people to this day that think there is some videotape of Dez Bryant beating up some girl in a parking lot. You've ever heard that?
I have. I remember that.
Oh, yeah. There are people say, oh, I saw it. No, you didn't. There's no video. But back at the time when a few years ago when Dez was getting his contract extension.
Was that like 16, 17?
Yeah, 2016. There was this scandal. Dez beat up some girl, a girlfriend in the parking lot, and there's videotape. To this day, this tape does not exist. But I recall different people in the media, not just Dallas-Fort Worth, nationally. Oh, yeah, this videotape, that's why the Cowboys haven't signed him and they want a low hometown discount and there's just, you know, his. I was like, there's no tape. We even had a police officer from Duncanville that was, you know, he said there's a, they have a videotape from the parking lot, but there's no what everybody's trying to claim exists. That's not on that tape. It's just nothing there. It's a regular old videotape from the parking lot, from the 24-hour security camera. But that ain't good enough for people. They want drama. They want conspiracy theory.
That's right.
And then I'm serious as a heart attack. There were people I admire and respect started suddenly saying, oh yeah, I saw that tape. It's bad. Oh my God. Cowboys are not gonna be. I'm like, you haven't seen that tape? Well, I have now. No, you haven't. To this day, no one. Notice Dez gets his extension. Nobody talks about it because it never existed. I'm bringing that up to tell you another story. That's just one. And the confirmation bias is when people don't want to be left out and say, oh yeah, I heard about that too. Oh yeah, I saw that. Instead of heard about it, oh, I saw it too. No, you didn't. You just don't want to be the one that didn't see it too. You don't want to be left out of the loop. Confirmation bias. Oh yeah, me too. I saw it too. No, you didn't. So I'm just saying, to this day, that tape don't exist, or you would have seen it by now or heard of it by now. Oh, I don't want to say I'm wrong, so I'm gonna say, oh, they squashed that tape. They just destroyed it. Oh, just in time for Dez to sign his new contract. Okay, you're right. Notice how these things just kind of just... So back in the day, when the Mavericks had the three J's, there's this legendary rumor. Jason Kidd, Jim Jackson, Jamal Mashburn. They were the big three in Dallas. It was like, oh, this team was exciting to watch. They got all these young superstars. And then the whole team crashed. They didn't like each other no more. What happened? Well, I heard that Toni Braxton, the superstar R&B singer, she broke them up. I have been telling the truth on this story for 30 years now. Mm-hmm. And I would tell the story so many times over and over and over again. And nobody would ever confirm this, the truth. But I would always say she had nothing to do with it. And because I talked to not only, first of all, Jim, Jason, Jamal, still real good friends of mine to this day. And I even talked to Toni Braxton about it. Well, I have no background music. No, not that. The CA, hey, Ross. The CA Stories music. I asked for the song. The background music. It just disappeared. Or excuse me, like I said earlier.
Uh-oh, hold on. Wait on.
Bag of the day.
Hold on. I mean, we're in safe harbor, but.
What's going on back there? Rigo's back there. Hey, what's up, Rigo? Are you distracting Ross from his job?
You breaking stuff back there.
Because this music right here, the CA Stories, it just disappeared.
Yeah, I was thinking that you wanted that music queued
up. No, I would say I want what I want. You know how I do. Okay, so back to this story.
Yes.
What had happened was this. The rumor was Jason Kidd was supposed to go out on a date with Toni Braxton in Atlanta because she's from the ATL.
Mm-hmm.
Or that's where her record label was. And I was on the road trip with him. Marriage played in Atlanta. And then he said, well, Jim Jackson shows up in a limo and just took her. From Jason Kidd, when Jason Kidd didn't come out of the hotel. And that broke up the Mavericks. That was not true. All right, so here's where it gets interesting. There's a new twist to this.
All right.
None of the participants, Jim, Jason, or Jamal, ever acknowledged it. When any reporter would ask them, what's this about you guys and Toni Braxton? They would all say, no comment. Because guess what? It was cool to be on TMZ and Entertainment Tonight, and I was like, wait a minute.
Right.
We're more than an athlete.
Yeah.
They're associating us with Toni Braxton. She's
right.
Fine.
Absolutely.
Halle Berry. Come on, man.
That is correct.
So they would always just say no comment because it's pretty cool to say. And just like, I have nothing to say about that. And they just kind of walk off or whatever. They just laugh. Well, the new twist on this is recently, in the last couple of weeks, Jim Jackson was on the Rich Eisen show. Rich was out, but his crew was there.
Mm-hmm.
And this buddy of ours who lives in Rockwall, he sent me the tape. He said, you get a kick out of this. Jim Jackson's on there and he's confirming everything I have said about this story for the first time ever. The rumor is squashed. I have been saying the facts and Jim finally confirmed everything. I'm listening to him like, what's he gonna change? Is he gonna tell the whole truth? Because he's never said it before. Jason's never said it before. Jamal had nothing to do with it. But the whole Rich Eisen crew was like, yeah, let's talk about the three J's. Let's talk about how Toni Braxton broke you, Jamal, and Jason Kidd up.
Right.
And Jim said, first of all, Jamal had nothing to do with this. It was the rumor was, and he talked about the rumor, was supposedly in Atlanta, J. Kidd was going to go out with Toni Braxton, but then here comes Jim Jackson in a limo. Now you can, for those who don't know who Toni Braxton is, maybe this might refresh your memory just a little bit, this song right here. Here you go, Ross. Thank you, sir. Remember that? Okay, so what had really happened was, and this is what I have been saying for 30 years, because I was on this road trip.
Yeah.
We're in New York. Same road trip. Atlanta first, then go to New York. When we get to New York, they got a game against the Knicks, but we're there a day early. So there's a little practice and all that. And Jim, they're asking, what are we going to do tonight? Well, somebody said Toni Braxton's in town, or she's doing some kind of meet and greet or something where all of them could get a chance to meet Toni Braxton.
Sure.
Jim had a limo because he had to make an appearance somewhere. Well, those guys never talked to each other. They said, okay, yeah, let me know. I'll be there. Nobody ever got back to Jim. So Jim said, okay, I guess nobody's going. And so him and Scott Brooks, who used to be a coach,
yeah,
he was a player back then,
yep,
for the Mavericks, they took the limo and they go out to eat. Next day, what happened to Toni Braxton? Y'all, nobody said anything. We didn't know. And so it was like a bit. It's like, oh, man. And Jacob, oh, man, how come nobody told me? I would have gone, blah, blah, blah.
Right.
Well, that's not what broke up the team. What broke up the team was those three were real tight. And then all of a sudden, they just became very competitive and it just fell out. Mm-hmm. Now they're all right now. But back then, they just kind of fell out. And they traded all the different guys away. So what had happened was quite simply this. They never met her. And then ironically, a year later, she comes to K104. She's in town. She comes to the studio. And I said, Tony, I do sports. And I was with the Mavericks. She said, oh, by the way, well, this is how it got out in the public. I'm leaving out this one important part. The reporter's like, what? How come these guys aren't getting along? And somebody said, it had to do with Toni Braxton. And so reporter's like, wait a minute. She's from Atlanta. They were in Atlanta. Mm-hmm. And that's what had it. Jim Jackson had a limo, but Jason Kidd didn't. What happened? So all of a sudden, this thing had a life of its own.
Yeah.
And so somebody tried to reach Toni Braxton. Her publicist issued a statement. Her new album was coming out. It was called Secrets. And the statement was, good girls never kiss and tell.
Mm-hmm.
That was the statement. We edged it all on even more.
No, nobody decided to put water on it, so it just continued to grow.
And so when Jim and Jason heard all of this, they're like, no comment.
Everybody, right.
No comment. Well, when Toni Braxton comes to town, she said, yeah, tell me about this, because I still haven't met them. I said, you have never met them. She says, not that I know of. Jim, later in this interview, returns to say, he said, I think I met her at a meet and greet, but that was before all of this. Mm-hmm. It's like, when I was real young, I met her at a meet and greet, but it was like, shake her hand. That was it. She don't know me. I don't know her.
Right.
This was just like 2 weeks ago. He's admitting that part. And I'm like, uh-huh. So I talked to Toni. I told Jay Kidd, and I even told Jim. I said, I talked to her. She hadn't met y'all. And then Jay Kidd, I still haven't met her.
Right.
Jim's like, I still haven't met her. This is years and years later. But the confirmation bias, there are reporters who cover the Mavericks. And Jim was talking about this. He said, I would talk to some of these guys. And they go, oh, yeah, I know the whole story because I was there. He said, it never happened. And I am the only one who has told the truth to this day. They have not met her.
Wow.
So Jim Jackson confirmed my true history of what really happened with the three J's. Toni Braxton had nothing to do with it. They just started having different kind of personalities and different arguing over credit, you know, stuff like
just
that.
The typical things that would break up a competitive team.
They're all the same age.
Yeah.
Basically, Jim got there first. He was 2 years older than Jay Kidd. Jamal got there the next year. And then Jason got there last. And they just started arguing over little stuff. You know, the different people around them started there. Hey, my guy. Alpha male stuff. Had nothing to do with Toni Braxton.
There you go.
There you go.
That's another edition.
The rest of the story. And like I said, confirmed by Jim Jackson 2 weeks ago on Rich Eisen.
There you go. There you go. So that's something that you can look up if you need a little bit of confirmation there. But hey.
So if you ever go on Google and it says Toni Braxton broke up the three J's, it's a lie.
Yes. And CA told you. CA told you first.
If you say there's a Dez Bryant tape, that's a lie.
There you go. Little CA Stories Confidential on a Monday evening. Thanks, Chris. Appreciate you.
Mm-hmm. There Appreciate you go. You too.
One more segment to go here on the Get Right on this Monday evening. It's called The Final Call. We'll do it next on The Fan. The smarter way to clean your floors. Get right here on 105.3 The Fan. Reginald Dettatula here with you alongside the three-time Hall of Famer Chris Arnold.
Got you down.
A lot of appreciation to our guy Ross Lubinsky on the ones and twos.
Buddy.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate the work that you've done this evening. Also, I guess a big shout-out to our guy Rodrigo Mendoza, who is leaving us for greener pastures.
Rigo, you want to say your final goodbye?
Tell everybody what you're doing.
Yeah, even though Mike Bassick and Corey gave it away last
that's right.
2 weeks ago.
Telling people's business.
Yeah, tell us. I'm heading out of Dallas Fort Worth, and I'm going to Laredo at KGNS. KGNS News is where you'll be able to find me from now on. And starting on April the 30th is kind of the route that I'm taking. I'm going TV, and I'm just excited. I'm really excited, and I love you guys. I really do. I'm going to miss doing shows like The Get Right, doing shows like The KNC Masterpiece, Kevin and Corey, awesome dudes, G-Bag, got a chance to do their show a couple times. And then Sean and RJ, I didn't get a chance to do their show, but...
In your face, Sean and RJ. hold that.
We're proud of you, man, and things will always work out great, and you can always come back to radio.
Yeah, no. I mean, I'm glad that I'm leaving on good terms. I think that's the best part about this whole thing is the fact that I'm leaving on some pretty good terms.
Very good.
Appreciate you and all the work that you've done for the fan and for the Get Right, man. Yes, sir. Congratulations. Safe travels being sent by various folks from the 214. Good food there, especially Taco Palenque. I don't know if I said that right. I definitely didn't. I'm guessing. You'll gain weight, they said. So you might want to be on your P's and Q's because you do have to be on TV.
Be careful when you go down to Nuevo Laredo, especially President's Weekend. I'll tell a story about that one of these days. Yeah, Holiday Weekend. Oh, my goodness. What goes on in Nuevo Laredo stays in Nuevo Laredo.
My biggest piece of advice for you, Rodrigo, just make sure that whatever suit you get them tailored because there's nothing that makes me more upset. And people wearing these suits that don't fit them right. So yeah, man, make sure you get you a suit that fits right. From 817, congrats, Rigo. Gonna miss you. Good luck. There's a lot of people texting, just saying goodbye, appreciating you for what you've done. So appreciate you, Rodrigo, for your time, your efforts, your work. Have a great and successful time in Laredo.
You bringing the family and the kids too?
Yeah. Yeah, he said that's the whole point. So, yeah.
There you go.
Congratulations, my man. We will miss you. It's the final call here on The Get Right. That's right. That's right. Final call here on The Get Right. And wanted to salute a legend in sports and baseball, Jackie Robinson, as
yes, sir.
Everybody on the diamond for the Rangers-Tigers game that the Rangers won 1-0. was wearing that patented 42 because it
Everybody
is Jackie Robinson
baseball
Day.
Period.
Of course, of course. I did want to localize it a little bit, mm-hmm. talk about the game that we saw earlier and we heard earlier today right here on 105 Through the Fan. But yeah, Jackie Robinson Day, obviously a huge day that baseball does a good job of celebrating and reminding folks of, remembering that, hey man, like, you know, Jackie Robinson integrated baseball. But one thing I wanted to highlight in this was the way in which I love that we celebrate him, but sometimes it feels like we're sanitizing mm-hmm. his legacy. And I always want to make sure that we remember Jackie Robinson whole, complete.
Yes.
In the ways that breaking the color barrier was not about Jackie Robinson's excellence. Even though he was an excellent human being and player, I often think about the idea that I don't believe that he was the best Negro Leagues player at that time. Right?
He was the one that they felt, Branch Rickey felt like he could handle it better than most.
And
all the pressures.
The reason why it's important.
He would not lose his mind.
Yes. And it brings me back to one of the things that I like talking about, which is the idea that the breaking of the color barrier was not an accomplishment by Jackie Robinson per se. Mm-hmm. It was baseball finding and realizing that they were not getting the best and realizing that they could open themselves up when they finally reached to a place that they could reasonably mm-hmm. open themselves up and get past bigotry to allow in great players. And one of the things that always is highlighted for me is the idea of what bigotry, what closed-mindedness gets you is missing out on some of the best things in life and some of the best people. Mm-hmm. And I mean, there's ways in which you could still see that now in the ways that, and it's some of the things that we talk about when we talk about hiring practices in football and when it comes to coaching and things of that nature, is that you're closing yourself off from more of the talent pool and not allowing yourself to get a Satchel Paige on the mound, right? And not allowing yourself to get a Josh Gibson. Like, you're not allowing yourself to get the greats. And Jackie Robinson, I think, made it abundantly clear, hey, if you allow yourself to get past that, you will find that there are great things beyond what the boundary that you've set up, especially if you have set it up on terms that mean nothing or that are not actually that do not actually matter. And so it's one of those things that I always want to bring up, in addition to the fact that the reason why Jackie Robinson, as you mentioned, was able to stay in stuff and the things that he was persevering through was in fact bigotry and racism. Like, we cannot forget those things, exactly. Right? Like, this was not just, he was not fighting against a nameless, faceless demon. That was something in particular. And in order to make sure that we do not fall into those same errors, we have to call them what they were and be very careful and deliberate about that. And so salute to Jackie Robinson, absolutely. But remembering the wholeness of that story, the entirety of it, without sanitizing it, because sanitizing it is how we mess around and maybe fall into the same mistakes.
That's why, if you can, it's available. You can stream it, whatever. See the movie 42, starring Chadwick, the late, great Chadwick Boseman. Yes, he also played Black Panther. You see that movie and you have an idea of why Jackie Robinson is so revered. And as Reg mentioned, tell the whole story. That story's all there.
There you go. So I wanted to salute, of course, the legacy of Jackie Robinson, the first man to integrate baseball, but not the first man to be good enough to play in the majors. The first one that the majors decided that they would allow to play baseball. Before we go, I did want to do this, a little bit of fun, to get away from my nagging. Boban, everybody loves him. They were playing, if I remember correctly, the Clippers.
Yes, the Rockets were playing Clippers the last game of the year.
And the Clippers, like a lot of places, have a, you know, promotion that if the opponent misses two free throws in the second half,
the home team's crowd gets pizza.
This is Boban doing things for the people.
Fans are getting excited here. There might potentially be some free chicken on the board if he misses the second free throw.
Oh man, free chicken on the board.
Yeah, so that's why the fans are getting a little frothy.
Oh, they're pointing to you. Bobo's playing with the crowd. Say, you want chicken?
Here's your job.
Oh, he gave him chicken. He's a man of the people. He's a man of the people.
He did that on purpose?
He did. He gave out free chicken.
And guess what? And the Rockets still won the game, too.
That's right. The game was out of hand.
He missed the free throws, yeah.
And Boban was like, I do it for the people.
I'm going to do it for the people. He's a movie star.
A servant, a man of the people. We salute you. That's it for the Get Right on this Monday evening. We'll be back, myself, CA, 7 to 11 tomorrow. Make sure you keep it locked here on 105.3 The Fan, where you'll have Rangers baseball at 11:30 is when it starts. Catch you tomorrow. Peace.
Text away your thoughts to the guys right now on the Truck Wreck.